It is a beautiful morning here in the Sabi Sands of South Africa, and it is a great pleasure to welcome you on board with myself. My name is Scott, and I'm teamed up with Dave on camera. We're really looking forward to this morning's adventure with all of you. Please let us know where you're watching, if it is your first safari. If it's not your first safari, you can also let us know anything interesting about what may be happening in your part of the world. As you can see, it's certainly not snowing here, but some of you may be frozen in the cold in various parts of the planet. The temperature here is about 25 degrees Celsius, which is about 77 degrees Fahrenheit. It's a nice cool morning. As you saw from Dave's opening shot, there's a few clouds in the sky. I'm not too sure whether they're going to burn off or not. It's a bit early to tell, but we've got quite a lot of cloud cover at the moment. I don't think we're going to get rain, although we would love some. It's incredibly dry here at the moment, and we are experiencing a drought, which is good for us. It's not ideal for the animals, but it does mean that the water holes have been incredibly productive for us. So we'll probably be popping into a few water holes later. And the good news for you guys is that Jamie Patterson is back from a very short leave, and she is going to be conducting a bushwalk this morning. I think she's planning on doing a kind of hybrid between driving and walking, because her goal is to try and help us track down the Inkahuma pride of Five Lioness. They were seen yesterday with James on the Sunset Safari, and we're last seen heading north. So we're going to go and check our northern boundary, make sure they haven't crossed out of Juma, and then start working out where they may be thereafter. Kevin Catfish and Tim, thank you very much for your updates regarding, your updates regarding the lion audio last night. And we are definitely going to be snooping around. The lions have been calling, it sounds like, from around 2 a.m. That was about 4 hours ago. And Dave seems to think they're moving from south to kind of east. I'd be very impressed if you're getting all of these calculations right. And hopefully one night we'll actually be able to be with the lions while they're calling, and then we'll be able to test your skills. Because it's incredibly difficult to pinpoint where animals are calling. I find it one of the hardest things to do out here in the safari world. And the reasons for it, I guess, is just like if you're having a conversation with a human, whether they're facing you or facing away from you, is going to have a huge impact on how clearly you hear them. So if there's a lion a mile away from you and it's facing the opposite direction to you, the call is going to sound incredibly different to if it turns around in that very same spot and roars towards you. So that's something to think about. Either way, thank you very much for your updates. And there's also some very interesting updates from Dennis and a few others regarding a crocodile fight at Pete's Pond that's apparently been going on for 9 hours. Fascinating stuff. I've hardly seen crocodiles in my years on safari. Not hardly seen them. I've seen a lot of them, but I've never seen them fighting. So that's awesome stuff. It sounds like there's a bully in the playground, and the fight is between quite a large crocodile and a smaller one. Interesting stuff. And I'm guessing it may have something to do with mating. And I know crocodiles will fight during their mating periods for kind of pools or areas along a river where females may reside, and then the male who's dominant in that area will get to mate with all of them. Apologies that my voice is a bit crackly. Not too sure what that could be. We'll have an investigation a little bit later once Jamie has headed out. Let's see if I can't tweak this little device. Let me just change holes quickly and see if that helps. It's probably not going to though. How's that? Any better? Still cracking. I'm guessing it's going to be worse. Sorry, we'll revert then. Whoops. Wrong hole. Come on. Anyway, that is the joy of being on a live safari in Accra. I forgot to mention that. Especially for the newer viewers. This is happening this very second. It's unscripted, unedited. We don't know what's going to happen. And that is half of the joy, well, the entire joy almost, of being on safari. The thrill of the unknown. Anything could happen. A buffalo could run across into the road right now, being chased by those five lion you're looking for. And if there's anything you would like to know about these live safaris, please communicate with us. It's extremely easy. Hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or email questions@wildearth.tv. Hello to Brian and Marilyn, a couple who have only recently discovered Safari Live just a week ago. And it sounds like you're hooked, which is great news. We love to invite and welcome more people to the Safari family. And the bigger the Safari vehicle becomes, the more places we're going to be able to take them. That is the exciting news about that. It is certainly the biggest Safari vehicle on the planet. And have you guys started a bird list yet? If you are new, that is something we recommend. It's a good way to get into ornithology, which is typically something that doesn't appeal to everyone, but a bird list tends to create that kind of human's natural competitive edge to try and gain more and more birds. So it's a good way to get involved in the little feathered friends that we have around here. And as I'm sure you've already realized, over the last week we've been spoiled with good sightings, but there are periods where game viewing can be a little bit quieter with regards to the bigger, higher profile game. There's always something going on, there's always something to talk about, and it just means you need to be a little bit open-minded. Anyway, David Manlin, it's great to have you with us, and thank you for your kind words. I'm happy that you are enjoying the safari so far. Marianne in Arkansas and your five-year-old nephew. You guys have been taking a closer look at Peter in the pond, which is in front of the Juma waterhole camera. And your young nephew seems to think that the hippos looks a bit shorter than he expected. And they are quite short animals. They've got very stumpy little legs, but they are very big, and don't be fooled. Those tiny little legs can help them move incredibly quickly. So even though they look quite big and slow, they are not. They're very powerful and much faster than any human on the planet. So that's something important to remember. Another thing that you guys would like to know is whether you think that that's just a friend that he is sharing the pond with, or possibly a girlfriend. And it's hard to say. I haven't had an incredibly close look at them. There is a chance it could be a girlfriend. The one does look a little bit smaller than the other, so maybe it is a girl. It's also not incredibly likely that a male would have accepted another male into a little pond that small. But, you know, strange things do happen out here. Maybe we'll go past a little bit later on and have a closer look. Nix, what exactly is the problem with the audio, just so that we know? Sorry guys, it sounds like this crackling. Okay, that we can fix. So, what I'm gonna do is try and put my lapel mic, this little device, on a different part of my shirt, and that will help. I didn't realize that there was a scraping sound. I thought there was just a general crackle, which are two different things. Okay. The joys of being on a live safari. Okay. Well, let's see if that helps. I've got it kind of pointing forward out of my chest like that. And maybe now that'll work better. Let's see. We're just trying out this new lapel mic. It's not the newest lapel mic on the market. I think Fred Flintstone actually used it when he was a star in Hollywood. So that may be the reason why we're experiencing some difficulties. But either way, I think this new positioning may work. No joy. there, Dennis in Canada, and you'd like to know my thoughts on this crocodile fighting at Pete's Pond. I've never even seen Pete's Pond, to be honest, so I don't know how big the pond is, which is, I guess, an initial drag would be giving any thoughts into this, but the reasons they could be fighting, I think, could be, like I said, possibly mating, or, like you've mentioned, maybe the drought is causing them to be in a confined area, there's not much water around, and that could be causing them to fight. That's very plausible. I'm not too sure how badly Botswana is being affected by the droughts, and specifically that area of Botswana, but it's certainly a good idea that you put forward there that the drought will be causing a little bit of increased tension, and we'll notice that between a lot of species, not only species that rely on living on water, but even species that just rely on drinking water, which is just about everything. So the waterholes are going to become an aggressive place. We are on our northern boundary here, so I'm just going to be leaning my head over the vehicle quite a lot, just making sure the Nkuhuma pride have not disappeared, and that way we can start working back into Juma. Quite tricky to see tracks this early in the morning with no sunlight. That's why I'm creeping along slowly. And now we're just going to do a little freewheel. That way, if there are any interesting noises nearby, we will be able to hear them. It didn't take long for me to think I heard something, but it was a false alarm. Hello to Dar, another new viewer, and thank you for getting in touch with us. And you're in Iowa. You'd like to know if lions will ever use buffalo dung for any kind of protection or to mask their scent. And no, the only thing that I've seen lion and leopard doing with buffalo dung is occasionally licking fresh dung that's almost still wet to obviously obtain various minerals and nutrients that they don't ordinarily get in their protein-rich meat diet. So that's the only thing that I've seen them doing through default. Like yesterday morning on the Sunrise Safari, one of the lioness had rolled in the buffalo dung, and leopards will actually sometimes do the same thing. Why? I guess it's the same reason. Why do you think your dogs will roll around in foul smelling dead animals or even sometimes feces from other dogs? Can't be explained clearly to me or by me. So, not too sure why that is, but it's certainly not going to cover their scent. Their own smell is going to be quite powerful. So there's no specific reasons that I think they do it. Other people may have other opinions on that, but I don't think there's any connection there. Calvin in Toronto, great to have you with us. You'd like to know how many leopards reside in this general area, and when is the best time in seeing them? Now, Calvin, the most leopards that we see here on Juma are probably two main females. It's Juma and Arethusa, so it's two main females, Karula and her daughter Shadow. Karula's 12 and her daughter is 9. And then we see a big dominant male called Tingana. He's chased away the old dominant male that we occasionally sometimes still see called Mvula, so that's 4. And occasionally one or two of Karula's sons may pop back in for a visit, or we may get a stray female coming in who doesn't actually belong here, but will come into this area in order to find Tingana, the big dominant male, in order with which to mate. So up till now, we've probably seen in the last year that I've been here, a total of around 5 leopards on average at any given stage. But over that period, we've maybe seen about 10 different ones, but it varies. It's typically, though, 3, Tsingana and the 2 ladies. So it's those 3 that we'll see quite often. Now, if you look on the ground over here, you're probably going to see just about nothing. However, as soon as I shine my flashlight, it may give you a better idea of what's going on here. You may be able to see more of an impression, more of a track. Here are the 3 lobes, 1, 2, 3, the back pad of a lion, 1, 2, 3, 4 toes, heading that way. Now, I'm not too sure how fresh this is. It could actually be from last night. So this Nkuhuma pride of lion may have been hunting here. What's interesting, though, is that I was expecting their tracks to be going the other way, but there's nothing to say they cross out and then chase some animals back in. It looks to me that I can see a lot of buffalo running here, or hoof prints. So I'm just gonna check up ahead a little bit more carefully. Give me a second. What I'm gonna be doing is checking very carefully to see if I can see any lion tracks on the central parts of the road that ordinarily would have been driven over. And that way you can kind of assume that the tracks are fresh.
Scotty.
Too far. Again, coming back. I thought this lapel might just start giving in.
Well, I'm not too sure what to suggest here. Because in an area where lions have had a bit of a kind of sleep and a rest, they'll have tracks going both up and down and backwards and forwards. But I'm battling to establish where in fact they have gone. Anyway, at least we've got their tracks. And let's just do a little bit of a drive around. We'll maybe be able to get some more clues as to where they are. All right. I should have put this little
thing on top. That would have been wise. Anyway, next time, that would have helped with my audio.
What I was doing when I was bending over and making a funny tail movement with my hand was, there's some hippo dung. There's a hippo that's come through here. And I'm not sure when exactly. Maybe it was after the lion, during the lion. There's a tiny little piece of dung on the road there. I'm not sure if now I've got the wrong angle here. Anyway, not critical. Let's just go and find these lions. There's lots of tracks up and down here. Nikki, you can let Jamie know that we are
50 meters east of Mbubu Road on Buffalo's cut line. They've been sleeping here, up and down. I fear, though, that they may have crossed into Buffalo's Hook. Here I can see where their tracks are coming towards us. They were somewhere down there on our left, basically, last night when James left them, so they would have been coming up in this direction. What to do, what to do? Okay. Now, for those of you who are new, I say this is our northern boundary. As you can see, there's not exactly a large fence here preventing us from going over there. And that's besides the point. We're still not going to go there. But what it means is that the animals have got free rein to go wherever they like. And that's important. The animals have not only got the Sabi Sands, the reserve that we are in here to roam around, but also the whole entire Kruger National Park is 3 million hectares. So a massive, massive reserve. As you can see, I'm being quite indecisive here. Can't work out which way I want to go, but I'm thinking maybe let's just go to Sydney's waterhole, see what's happening there. It's the closest water to where we are here. And maybe they've decided to head over there for a drink, or just to try their luck in general. Like I say, there've just been tracks going up and down in every direction. To draw in Berlin, and you just joined us 3 days ago, and you're wondering if the incredible luck that we've been having is because of you. And I would love if that is the case. We'll give you a full-time job. You can even come and stay here. We just need to prove that you are in fact the reason that we've been having such good game viewing. It could also be, like you say, that it's the droughts that's causing good game viewing. A lot of the animals are relying on the water holes. It's a lot easier to find them now that the vegetation is quite open and sparse, and again, that they're relying on the water holes. So I think it's a combination of your good luck and the droughts that is causing us such good game viewing. I'm glad we came the way we did, because I found some lion tracks here. They are not easy to see at all in this overcast light. The easiest one to see, I think, is a little bit too close. Or will you be able to get this one, Dave? Too close. But they have headed up. At least there's one of them that is heading up this road. This time of the year, or this kind of weather, not typically this time of the year difficult, is that because the ground is so soft and dry and dusty, it retains tracks for quite long. And even though we've got tracks with one line here that I would have thought was going up there, maybe it's veered more in this direction. Let me just double check. But I can't see any further tracks, which means maybe that one track that I can see that looks quite fresh actually isn't. Okay, well, this is creating a lot of confusion for me. Let me just check one more area, sorry. Joy. I can't wait for where these few little tracks that I can see here. But let's just continue on and see what happens. It's a tricky thing to track and keep you guys entertained, so apologies, but at the same time we do want to find Lion. So forgive me if I neglect you temporarily whilst focusing on trying to work out what's what. Told to turn this device onto auto. Do you have any ideas how that could be? I'll just unplug it then and see if we can work it off. Okay, so apologies again for the tech issues here. But that, like I said earlier, is the joy on being on a live safari. You get to see all the glitches along the way. How it works is that the lapel mic that we're trying to fix now is supposed to just be for my voice, and then there's also a mic on the top of the camera that's supposed to be for that kind of ambient noise around us. So, it sounds like Jamie Patterson is about to get, or she is ready to receive you guys, and the only last little nugget of information that I'd like you guys to pass on to her when you do jump onto her vehicle is that the Lion tracks are on Buffalo's Hook Cut Line, just east of Mvubu, heading up and down. I can't work out which way they have gone. So, please pass on that message and we will catch up a little bit later. Enjoy the bushwalk.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And much like Scott, we are also having a look at Lion tracks. And since we've got such a perfect example, for those of you who are unfamiliar or maybe haven't had the close-up view that we get to have with this camera, just have a look at this beautiful track that's come through. You've got the back pad here, the three lobes at the back, and then the one, two, three, four toes. What's really interesting about this, and as wonderful it is as it is to be back again and back on Juma and tracking Lions once again, what's really interesting is that yesterday afternoon I was on the back of Brent's vehicle and they were heading off in completely the opposite direction towards where Scott is. I just came to where we left them out of curiosity, and they went off in that direction last night when we left them on the Sunset Safari going straight north, and they actually cut back and their tracks came all along this game path and straight towards Galago Pan. Interesting how they decided to change direction completely. Makes sense, they were thirsty and this is the nearest water. But yes, what an exciting way to start our sunrise safari. So exciting, in fact, that I started off my sunrise safari an hour earlier and woke up Scott and Nikki thinking it was 4:30 when in fact it was 3:30. Spent the hour feeling very, very silly. Now the Lions have gone off towards Galago Pan. I think though that they probably then cut north back to where Scott was on Mvubu Road. And I think that's our plan of attack, is to head in that direction and see if we can't bump into them somewhere in the block. It's interesting to listen to the calls of the morning as well. I can hear hyenas calling and shouting to us, that constant contact call from the den site. And it would be interesting to see if there was any kind of interaction between the lions and the hyenas. And what I'm looking at now is that there are lots and lots of fresh hyena tracks over the top of the lion tracks. So that's, this is probably when we left them on the sunset safari. Here's a tiny little hyena track of the sub-adults here. Having seen that lion track that we started with first thing in the morning, this is a tiny little back track. Just that little shape there. How do I know it's a hyena? It looks like a puzzle piece. Toes fitting perfectly together. And then the tiny back pad heading straight back towards the den. So interesting. The lions and the hyenas probably had some kind of interaction at some point last night. This is one of my favorite areas to walk. It is the drainage line system that runs to the north of Galago and Vuyatela. Another fascinating factor that I learned yesterday, from when I started working here, which was tracking lions. Can you hear lions? Oh, there we go. That's on property. One thing I want to do is just contact Scott and ask him if he heard that. It is probably, my guess would be, in that block between Mvubu and Gowri Cutline. Scott?
Jamie, I fear your hopes that they're on Juma are incorrect. I'm
at
the top
no.
of the signboard here, and it sounded like they're on north of us.
Oh, Scott's sitting at Biffle's Hook Cutline at the signboards, and he says that they are north of that particular area. I'm just trying to listen for a second. To me, it sounded a little bit...
What is your position now, Jamie?
A little bit closer. Let me just communicate with Scott. We're just close to Galago Pan.
Yeah, no. There's been tracks just east of Mvubu, up and down, and then from where I am at Galago Shortcut, Buffles of Cutline, they sounded north and east of us.
Okay, copy that, thank you. All right, interesting. Scott says that they are to the north of us. On this nice cool morning, it doesn't mean that they are not going to come through, and I think that's still my plan of action, to see if we can find those lions. There's still a good chance that they could wander through and wander south in this direction from where they are in Biffle's Hook. It's quite a long distance towards the water, and they've either got to move back towards Galago Pan, and I know that they were looking hungry last night. Now it's interesting that even now walking through this area, I feel as though I can smell the odd, every now and again I get a whiff of lion, essentially. And I think that in general acts as a deterrent for the animals that come through. And Annie was wondering, or was saying, that it feels like a wild dog morning. And what are the chances that we're actually going to see wild dogs on a morning like this morning with the lions around? Wild dogs are fairly unpredictable, Annie. They could be anywhere. The last we heard of the Sands Pack, they were all the way down south towards Newington, apparently. As for where the Investec Pack is, I really honestly have no idea. I did notice that during the time sort of around December, January, where the Nkuhumas and the rest of the lion prides were pretty much sort of to the east and to the south of us, we saw a lot more of the wild dogs. Whether that's connected or not is a question that's up for debate. There's definitely a link between lions and wild dogs in terms of their movement. But Annie, I wouldn't say that the fact that the lions have been around would act as any kind of necessarily a negative in terms of our chances of seeing wild dogs. I still think that it's distinctly possible that we could encounter them. So we'll see. It could be a wild dog morning, it could be a hyena morning, it could be an elephant morning. We just have to wait and find out. And as the sun slowly breaks over the horizon, I believe that Scott has a very beautiful view to show you.
Wow, isn't that a spectacular view? This is our northern boundary called Buffles Hook Cutline, and it heads all the way, as you can see, directly east. What a magnificent view. Now,
We are a lot closer to those lines than Jamie was, so it's a lot easier to pinpoint their course. But just like I said earlier, it's not easy to work out where these animals are. Jamie thought they were on Juma, but they are considerably further north of us. So whether it's the Inkahumas or another pride, I am not even going to hazard a guess. Whether it's a lion or a lioness, again, I'm not going to hazard a guess because it is not easy to be certain. And very often I hear guides, very experienced guides, saying the lions are calling there, it's a male. And then you go out on drive and it's lioness calling in a very different place. So be careful when trying to forecast where animals are calling, because it can very easily make you look like you don't know what you're talking about. Hello to the Siberia Zumi, one of the kind people who controls the Juma waterhole camera, hence the name Zumi, that is what they are called. The people who jiggle the remotes and get you the shots. And you'd like to know a little bit more about how lions and coalitions work out when young males like Junior, who was a young male in the Inkahuma Pride, would it have been possible for him to join up with his fathers had they not been chased off by the Birmingham boys? Unlike the Siberia Zumi, it's not common, it's highly unlikely that a son, almost impossible that a son would be allowed into their father's coalition, because it would defeat the whole object of the father's roles, and that is to chase their sons away into new areas so that they can go and spread their genes elsewhere without interbreeding with their sisters and mothers. Now, of course, that can happen, and I'm sure it has happened from time to time, but the general idea is that they need to move away from their natal pride, and that is typically what happens. Either their father chases them away, or, like in this scenario, it could well have been the Birmingham Coalition who initially chased his father away, Junior, and then he realized, jeez, this is not a safe place to be with these five young males that are going to tear my head off if they get a hold of me. So that's why he's moved off. Now, it's simply unfortunate for him, and that's life. I guess some people get lucky, and some people get unlucky, and it's the same with animals. The Birmingham Coalition can consider themselves lucky because they had brothers and cousins all of a similar age that they could move off with and create this very powerful coalition. Junior, on the other hand, not so lucky. No brothers, and therefore, you know, he's getting off to life on the back foot, you could say. Not easy. I wonder where he is, if he is still even alive. Who knows? Got some zebra here on our left. Possibly two stallions, I'm guessing that's what the case is. Yep, that's what it looks like. Two young stallions that have not managed to yet find a harem of ladies for themselves. Well, we've got a safari guy called Ben on the east coast of America who has been doing his homework. And well done, Ben. It's great to do some research just before you head out on safari. And it's applicable, the research you did today, because you would like to know a little bit more about the zebra that we get in South Africa. And you've read about the Burchell zebra, one of the subspecies. And this is, in fact, the Burchell zebra that we are looking at, also known as the plain zebra. What I am going to do is get out my mammals book and show you some of the other zebra that you get in Africa. In South Africa, we only get the Cape Mountain zebra or the Hartman zebra. They're much of a muchness, but slightly different. And their stripes basically finish quite high up on their stomach. They don't go all the way under their belly. And they're quite close together, you'll notice their stripes. Also, they lack the shadow mark on the center of the stripes that the Burchell zebra have. So you get these also in terms of distribution If you don't mind just going up, oh, I can just move this. If you just zoom in here a little bit, Dave, they are few and far between and more in the western parts of Africa and southern Africa. This next country up where they're in red, which is the Hartmann zebra, is Namibia, and then we get the Cape Mountain zebra in the kind of Cape and central southern parts of South Africa. So those are those two, and then let me just turn over the page quickly and show you the, oh, this is one of my favorite, but sadly you only get these up in East Africa. They are hypnotizing. Look at that. The Grevy zebra. They've also got massive donkey-like ears, very close stripes together. Kind of similar to the mountain zebra in that their stripes finish quite high up in the belly. But if you don't mind just zooming in onto this and wait for this hypnotizing effect. I mean, look at that bottom. Very, very sexy bottom for a zebra. As we continue, the plain zebra, also known as the Burchell zebra. And this is interesting because they do have a slight difference, kind of, this slight subspecies of this Burchell zebra, even though they occur, I'm just gonna whip this down here, kind of throughout South Africa, not throughout South Africa, but large parts of Africa, all the way up into East Africa, they look a little bit different in various parts of Africa, but that is the Burchell's or the Plains zebra. Very good, Ben. Thank you for getting us onto that topic, and also thank you to those two zebra stallions for being in the right place at the right time. Aha! So, Joel, in New York, you've mentioned that draw in Berlin may not be the only reason why we've been lucky, and there may be a reason a little bit closer to home, and that is that David, our new cameraman sitting on the back of this vehicle, has brought all the luck, and literally, since he arrived, he and us have been spoiled with non-stop action on only his second drive ever. He got to see a cheetah, bearing in mind the last one was seen 7 months ago. So thanks for pointing that out, Joel, and draw in Berlin. You're gonna have to come up with some very conclusive evidence here to prove that you are bringing us the luck. But either way, I think the more the merrier is the bottom line. The more people that join in, the luckier we are gonna get. Lucy in South Bend, you would like to know a little bit more about Dave, and we're just going to do this in small increments. Firstly, Dave, where exactly in this fine country of South Africa are you from?
I'm from Johannesburg.
Johannesburg, so it's from the central parts of South Africa, a concrete jungle, so I'm sure you're enjoying the fresh air and open spaces out here.
Absolutely.
And another one, a good one, is what is your favorite animal?
Oh, that's easy. That's the wild dog.
The wild dog. Okay, so David and Brent are on the same page here. And we're in luck. It looks like some zebra are coming down to drink. If we just pan across to the right a little bit, Dave, they should slowly start popping into frame. I saw them disappearing behind one or two bushes, so we might just have to be a little bit patient, but they are on the way for a drink.
Morning, mobile stations. Any updates?
There they come, running in excitedly. You may have heard that radio transmission come through. Look at how cool this is. And that was Craig from Cheetah Plains, another guide who I'm just going to let know what's going on so far. Morning, Craig. No updates. It looks like trucks and audio of the Inkahuma Pride are north of Mvubu Road, Buffalo's of Cut Line. Negative. There's been no further signs and it doesn't look promising.
Just confirming that area is
zoned off. Yeah, at the moment no areas are zoned. It's a free-for-all.
Okay, sorry, that was just some important discussions, and I must just welcome him back quickly. Welcome back as well, Craig. Quackly. By quackly, I mean quickly.
Thank you.
And he's been on leave, and he was just asking some updates on Karula, the female leopard who did have at least one cub. We had one confirmed sighting of the cub, and then extracted ourselves entirely from the area of that den site to give her all the space and time that she needed. What I'm going to do is try and peep through into a little gap where we'll get you some better views of these zebra drinking. We've seen them running around now. And like I say, as soon as we realized that there was a cub, we moved away, and judging by her behavior, just all the little clues and signs where we have seen her since that day, which was about 2 weeks ago, probably a little bit more than 2 weeks ago now actually, there's been no conclusive evidence that she still actually has cubs, which is no great surprise really, because leopards, as well as lion, have got a very high mortality rate of their young, which is just a sad reality of the African wilds. But it's not over yet. We may be lucky. I'm just going to try and peek through a little gap, which is just over here, that Nikki actually pointed out to me yesterday when we were on a staff drive. Is it going to work? Oh, jackpots. So it's a slightly different view, and at least we can see them drinking now. All lined up at the bar. Looks like it's happy hour, judging by their tails. Interesting that the two foals are standing behind there like they're the security guards. It should be the other way around, you would think. But maybe they got to go first. Hard to be said. Now, I'm told James thought he saw a crocodile in this waterhole the other day. It's possible, but I don't trust him because the binoculars that he uses are ones that he inherited from Vasco da Gama and are not very efficient and effective, so he could have been seeing anything really. John Bradford, great to have you with us. You would like us to try and provide you guys with more maps, bird lists, mammal lists of the area. And I think that's a great idea. I will put that forward to the powers that be, because I'm certainly not going to be the one that does that. But it is a great idea. What I can do is show you a quick map of the general area. John, I don't know how long you've been with us for exactly. So I don't know if you have seen this map before. But basically what we've got here is a map of Juma. This is that square over here, Juma on the right, and this is Arethusa. These are the two properties that we can traverse. The blue dots indicates where we are. We're right at the northwestern corner of Juma at the moment. So we might be able to try and get this map up onto the website. But like I say, I will pass that message on to the relevant people who look after those kinds of things. So apologies, it is a great idea though, both the map as well as the bird lists and mammal lists. But in the meantime, what I'd suggest doing is at least just writing the animals down on a piece of paper, and then you can just catch up the list if and when it does get published onto the website. We're gonna head off probably to Arethusa. I want to take Dave across there to show him some scenery that he hasn't seen yet before. And while we do that, we are going to send you to ground level with Jamie.
By this mesmerizing sight of a harvester termite collection at work. And just watch these incredible creatures. They've gathered all of this debris around them, the grass around their hole, And they're now coming out to collect it. Let's see if this one's going to grab one. And it is so fascinating to watch the way that they are working and dragging it down. These are harvester termites, which, as the name, just watch the way that they work and drag. Here we go. We're sorry for the little bit of breakup that we had there. Oh, that's an enormous one that the harvester termite is trying to get down the hole. And it's also really interesting to watch the size differences between the workers. Come on, guys, I need you to come out so I can show the viewers. But the smaller ones targeting the little pieces of wood and the larger ones going for the bigger ones, which totally makes sense. And you have to wonder at their processing ability, converting this down below in their termite mountains to food. And you can see that pale color that I was talking about. The pale colour that's an adaptation, as I mentioned earlier, to the fact that they are essentially nocturnal, or on a cool day they might come out. Very, very sensitive to temperature and sun. So it's intriguing to wonder what they were up to last night, and did they gather this all around them, all of these sticks and twigs, for the morning, where they then start transporting it down into their hole. And some of the pieces are absolutely phenomenally big compared to the size of the insect. And I don't want to scare them, but just to give you a bit of a scale and perspective, some of the sticks and twigs are longer than my finger, and yet they've been carried by these little creatures all the way down into their hole. How interesting is that? Grabbing them, that strength that they have within their way that they interact with the sticks and twigs that they use. And Tony, you were wondering how big they are. Probably less than the length of my fingernail is maybe a good reference point. About half the size of my fingernail, half the length of my fingernail. Those are the main workers. Every now and again, there's a bigger one, a slightly thicker, longer, stronger one. And it's still workers. It's not the soldier termites that would come out in defense of these burrows or networks of burrows. Now, harvester termites, of course, are a completely different species from the termites that live in those giant termite mounds that we see. Totally different approach, and we've got no termite mounds around us, no system of vents or holes to control the temperature in the same way that different species do. And I'd be interested to know, because as far as I know, harvester termites do have an interesting relationship with a fungus. It's called a tomatomyces fungus that is completely dependent on the termites. The termites farm it. They keep the temperatures constant, as we've spoken about with those large systems of vents. What's happening here? Look at this. What is that? The ants have got hold of the termites. That's really interesting. This is the exoskeleton of a termite that I thought was still wandering around. But you can actually see the ants have got hold of it, and they're trying to either break it apart or drag it off towards their nest. Chatting about strength. Whoop! That's one ant pulling something that's probably about 100 times its size. That's amazing. It's got it by the leg. The termite's dead. Here we go. Teamwork going on there. Dragging it along. And of course, a completely different approach from the ants compared to the termites. Termites breaking down and utilizing the parts of the wood, whereas ants are more carnivorous in nature. I'm going to take this termite back towards wherever their particular nest might be. And we're sorry if we disappear every now and again. It's just because we're in a system of drainage lines. We're not in the drainage line, we're actually on the crest or the rise. But every now and again, the picture tends to disappear, but still worth absolutely showing you this incredible sight. And it's so fascinating to see them in such close proximity. The termites working on one side, and the ants removing a dead termite. And I don't know whether or not they killed it or whether the termite just died naturally. They have very, very short lifespans. And the termite's busy making the most of the cool morning and the opportunity to drag all of these little bits of sticks. The industrious nature of these insects is phenomenal. Now, I know that we did have a question about what do they do when they drag these sticks down. And Africa, I think it was you who was asking about what are they doing when they drag those sticks down? What are they up to? And they're breaking them down, so they partially digest them. And that's where the fungus comes in, because termites can't necessarily digest all of the cellulose and the plant material that goes down. But fungus, of course, can. So they farm the special type of fungus. They look after it in favor of all other. If there's any kind of other fungus that starts to grow, they'll actually remove that and move on. And then take the waste products that the fungus produces. Look at it go. Dragging it down. And into the hole. And B. Wilson, you're thinking along the same line I am. They are so industrious. They're now dragging all of it down. And you were wondering, well, how long does it take to collect all of this wood around their hole? And B. Wilson, I have to be completely honest with you. I have no idea. My guess would be that it's pretty much a night's work because of the numbers that they have. And the fact, just watching them, the sort of constant motion that they perform, I think that on a cool day like today, I think they could probably drag most of these little pieces down into the hole. What I would be interested to see is whether or not they chop up some of the larger pieces into little bits in order to get them down, because some of those pieces are not going to go down, like this one that's currently stuck in it. It's fascinating to watch. And Safari, it's been a while since I've heard your name, but I have been on leave, but welcome back. Taking a bit of a break, but Safari wants to know how much in terms of percentage of their body weight can they lift. And as far as I know, they're not quite as strong as the strongest recorded insect, which is a species of dung beetle, or rhino beetle. They are within the same sort of family. Oh, this one's stuck. Pull. Come on, you can do it. Working together to try and get that one piece down. They haven't planned this very well at all. But Safari, you were wondering about the body weight percentage. I think it's something in the region of 800% of their body weight. So immensely powerful creatures. Here we go. That was a lazy choice, mister. Took the smallest possible option. It's fascinating to see them pulling it down. And speaking of it, just to give you an idea of how far the termites have moved, or the dead termite has moved or been dragged by the ants. Come all the way along. Let me move that out of the way. It's come all the way along to here. That's probably a distance of about, I don't know, 5 inches in the time that we were distracted and watching the termites move. Now, Jim Butler is watching and wondering, what are the major predators in terms of what would eat the termites? Trying to see if there's some kind of nest or colony somewhere around here. I'm sorry, VM. He's sitting on it. Oh dear, poor VM. Perhaps we should get up and move now. We're done with our termite expedition. Poor VM sitting with ants coming up his trousers. Sitting somewhere in the middle of an ant's nest around here. I'll try not to walk on it. So Jim, you were wondering about what the main predators of these ants or termites might be. And Jim, the answer to that is generally your biggest predators will be a combination of aardvarks and pangolins will often diet on the termite species around here. I've noticed particularly in this area the way in which, or the number of different aardvark burrows that I've seen. And Steph and I were just discussing how it works and what the aardvarks go about doing in their night. Do they move from burrow to burrow to burrow? Do they focus on one burrow? Is it one aardvark? Is it many? We know that yesterday with Brent, when he was trying to reposition to get a view of the lions, we chatted a little bit about the dangers of driving and the fact that if you drive over an aardvark burrow, it is going to collapse under your vehicle and you'll find yourself stuck. May not have done that once or twice in exactly the same place. Once with Andrew and once with Brian, I think, following Tingana. Just one interesting aside, I've been clutching this and I'm probably going to relocate it back into the wild from whence it came. That walk that I did, for those of you who may or may not remember it, a couple of weeks ago in the morning, we chatted a lot about this species of snail. Obviously, this is a deceased version, but you can see compared to the ones that we saw, there's that dark stripe that runs along the side. And if you remember, if you cast your mind back, it had that little cap around the entrance to the shell. And I mentioned that I didn't have a clue what particular species it is. Well, we've been doing some investigating, and I must thank Steph for his contribution to that and his determination to figure out exactly what they are. And the answer is we don't actually have an answer as to what species they are. But it's strongly suspected that they're an exotic or an introduced species of snail, which is why we've never seen them. And interestingly, you get population explosions that don't necessarily happen every single year, but might happen once every 5 years, which is why I personally have never observed them. It took us a long time, and we still haven't completely figured out exactly what that particular species of snail is. I'm actually going to keep the shell. I said I was going to relocate it, but I'm going to keep it. Now what I'm doing as I investigate along is to just double check and see whether or not I can see any more of that extensive termite burrow. And Jill and Safari were sort of wondering a little bit about the termite colony size. And the answer is, whilst it's not quite to the same extent of those giant termite mounds that we see, which are essentially a tip of an iceberg, where you see maybe about an eighth to a tenth of the actual termite network, and the rest of it is below ground, but they still have a very, very extensive network of burrows. I couldn't give you an exact size, but I will say that it does stretch cover immense areas under the ground. And I'm sure many of you will have seen the experiments that they conducted where they poured concrete into a termite burrow and just explored the network and the way that it's constructed. Fascinating to witness. I have a quiz for you since we're here, and I want to see if you can get this. Actually, I want to see if I can get this. I'm just having a look at this dung pile here. Tiny, tiny, tiny little pieces of dung. So let me try and stand up so that Vildi doesn't have to bend down, because it appears that every time we do, we lose signal. Little. And I want to know if you can guess what particular animal is responsible. Part of your track and sign quiz for this morning. Let's try and break it open. Here we go. It's a good way, always, if you're trying to determine what particular species is responsible for the defecation you are observing. It's a good idea to break it open and have a look, unless of course you suspect that it is either predator or omnivore. There we go, very finely digested, and it is a herbivore of some sort. What would you suspect that might be? That's a really good, really, really good idea. Safari Dean suggested, while we plan our route, since the Nkuhuma ladies have decided to be hugely inconvenient and wander off property, Safari Dean has suggested maybe we should go back and check the termite hole at the end of the walk. Well, I've got to go back that way towards the vehicle. So Safari Dean, stay tuned. We might decide if I can find it again. I have to be honest, it's surprisingly difficult to find that specific point in an area like this. But if I do manage to relocate it, I will definitely try and do so. In the meantime, though, I didn't even notice. Curious One is really enjoying my current knee decoration. Thank you, Curious One. I've also managed to scratch myself at some point. I think it was probably yesterday. Don't remember doing that this morning. But thank you, curious one. I will I'll add to the decoration as the walk goes on. I think I might even have it on my elbows as well. Yeah, just a little bit. Just patches of dirt. Oh, it's all in the name of exploring the fascinating little thing, which is, of course, what the bushwalk is all about. And while we go off in search of more wonders and fascinating things, let's find out what the wonderful and fascinating Scott has to tell you.
Well, you've joined us at a good time. I've literally just spotted some lion tracks, which I really wasn't expecting to see. It's a pleasant surprise. They're not going to be easy for me to show you. They are very, very tricky to see here. They're going in the opposite direction to where we've come, though. And I wonder who they belong to. Anyway, we'll just keep that in mind and continue venturing forth. They're heading into an area where it's going to be very difficult for us to check effectively where we haven't already checked before. We're kind of in the northwestern corner of Juma still. And the only way to effectively be able to work out exactly where they've gone from here would be for me to get off and spend a lot of time on foot. So, because you can't come with, we're just going to forget we ever saw them. But not forget completely, just keep that in the back of our mind. But there was tracks of at least one lioness heading up this road. Interested to know a little bit more about the bushwalks and whether we've had any dangerous encounters, specifically so with lion. And nope, I have not had one lion even growl at me since I've been at Juma. They either just look at you from a distance and or move off. Now, I would like to attribute that fact to the way that we conduct our walks and the way that we handle ourselves when on foot. Because if you don't know what you're doing and you stumble online and you get too close to them, then they will growl at you. So the fact that we haven't had any really dangerous encounters, we haven't had to chamber around once, so we haven't even got to a point where we think it's necessary to put a bullet into the chamber in case we may need to shoot an animal. And that's because every single one of us that's been walking, did anybody hear what that guy said? Not easy. That's the story of our lives. Anyway, the bottom line is no, we've had no dangerous encounters, and I attribute that to mainly skill and the fact that we're experienced on foot and we don't put too much pressure on the animals, and also luck, because even the most skillful, experienced trails guide, which is the term used for people who spend time on foot in the bush, that's the qualification you need in order to be able to walk clients, not just drive them. But driving's a lot easier qualification to get than the walking qualification, because it is that much more dangerous to walk, considerably more dangerous to walk. But yes, like I said, so far no dangerous encounters. Also, well, nothing too serious. Of course, your adrenaline may race from time to time. Another important thing to remember, and this is fundamental, is that animals do not want to fight. Humans are much more inclined to aggression and fighting with one another and with anything really than animals are. Animals will typically only fight in very unique scenarios. They often vocalize and display posturing, shouting at one another before actually physically coming to blows like us humans tend to do. So that obviously puts us in a very fortunate scenario where animals will very seldom actually attack us. It does depend on where you are. One pride of lion will vary from the next, but the lions that we see are generally quite nervous of us. Thank you. to Ava Brooks, and you would like to know the smell of a lion. And I can't really pinpoint it. They're not the smelliest of animals, and the only two animals that I can think of that you can easily smell in terms of their actual body, and when you're nearby, or three animals you can smell quite easily, are wild dog. They are very distinctive. They smell kind of like a wet dog blanket, really, with maybe kind of, if you were to stew a dog blanket, an old dirty dog blanket in a big pot, and if you were to maybe crumble in some blue cheese, or maybe it's not blue cheese, maybe that's too strong, maybe like a camembert or something like that, that's the smell of wild dog. Elephants, when they are in must, sexually heightened stage, it's quite a sweet smelling odor that you can smell from a long distance away from them. You can often smell them before you see them. A sweet smelling what? Oh, almost like a sweet smelling, slightly fermented fruit salad, maybe, would be the elephants. So that's the wild dog, the elephant, and then the last animal that is easy to smell out here in the African wilderness is the waterbuck. They've also got kind of a wet, blankety smell, but not a dog blanket, just a regular blanket that's become wet. Another way that I like to describe the smell of elephants in must, and it's nothing like a sweet fermenting fruit salad, but for those of you who ride horses, there's that smell of horse's sweat. Often if you take the saddle off a horse, and it's quite sweet, there's something to do with that kind of horsey sweat smell that resembles that of an elephant in must. But lions not smelly, leopards not smelly. Of course they will smell if you were to, you know, cuddle them and roll around with them, but we're never that close to them, Ava. I'm sure the breath of a lion is not very pleasant, but again, I've never been that close to one. Well, it sounds like Jamie Patterson has found you another animal close to this, close to the ground, and it has got very cryptic camouflage. Good luck finding it.
Now, I hear that Scott has been discussing the various scents and smells of the bush, and whilst examining the different scents and smells of the bush, we found an animal, and I want to see if you can spot it, because I have to be honest, it's some of the most incredible example of camouflage I think I've ever seen, and something I've never actually observed before. See if you can spot what I'm looking at, and in fact I might shift around so that Liam can have another perspective. See if you can spot what I'm looking at. What animal am I viewing? Oh, it gave itself away. There is an insect here. I don't want to scare it away, but just in front of the stick that I'm putting forward. Can you see it now? How incredible is this dirt-colored, what looks like a locust, it's a grasshopper, sorry, it is a grasshopper. And it's perfectly matches the dirt, and this is a pile of elephant dung. It's an old pile of elephant dung that's already been started to be utilized and broken down by the termites. That's what's given it that sandy color and has stuck it together with sort of almost muddy-like texture, or sandy texture. And this incredible little insect, this incredible grasshopper, is something I've never seen before. It is perfectly adapted to its environment. Now, I suspect, and we've discussed this before we showed it to you, the way in which it is camouflaged suggests that it is able to utilize, essentially able to utilize areas that other grasshoppers wouldn't be able to, because they'd stand out clearly. So in a nice open area like this, and particularly in this particular area, which is full of different samples of elephant dung and different and perfectly matched to the color of the soil, this little insect is capable of utilizing it in place of all of the other grasshoppers. It doesn't have to compete for food, and it doesn't come at a risk of being eaten by something, eaten, spotted by a bird, because I cannot imagine a way in which this insect would be seen by a bird. I can't even begin to guess what would be able to find it and predate on it. Interesting. It's dropped its feelers down. And obviously it's perfectly aware that it's been spotted. Insects do have quite intense vision. They see in different spectrums of light to you or I, and they're capable of seeing infrared in certain insect species. It's one of the techniques that, of course, flowers utilize in order to attract their pollinators. But they do have very, very good eyesight. So he knows, he, she, it knows that it has been spotted and is relying completely on the camouflage to keep it safe. And what I've noticed as well is these two little symmetrical spots on the legs, and I'm fairly certain that this is going to be an insect that displays what's known as flash coloration. So if I were to disturb it, which I'm not going to do, but if I were to make it jump, it's probably got either a lighter color or a brighter color on the inside of its legs. And what that means is when it explodes into action, when it jumps, the attention of the predator that's after it will be entirely attracted to that bright flash of color, or even absence of color, so a nice light color. And as soon as it's jumped, it will then land, fold its legs in, and that flash of color will disappear. And the predator's attention is where that it last saw that flash of color rather than where the animal actually is. You see it in frogs, you see it in insects, and even with the little antelope species. For example, a little steenbok with the flash of white underneath its tail. You'll watch them as they dash away. They have their tails up. You see that flash of white. And then when you look at them once again, when they stop, they drop their tails and they go completely still and rely on their sort of cryptic coloration. And I'm fairly certain that that's what this grasshopper would use as well. Definitely one of the most intense examples of camouflage I think I've ever seen outside in this particular area. The other really good example, which is something I've been looking for ages to be able to show you, is an insect that's taken it even further. It's known as a bagworm. And bagworms collect, for example, textures like this elephant dung, this old elephant dung that's completely dried up. They gather it around them. Ooh, it is there. Sorry, got distracted. Looks like the exoskeleton of a pool millipede. There we go. There's a little bit of grass in the way. Oh, it's falling apart. It is the exoskeleton of a pool millipede. It was already dead when I dug it out. You can see it's starting to fade to white, as they do once they lose that pigment when they die. And they start to just leave the sort of calcium and keratin of their exoskeletons. But you can actually really get an idea of what's hiding inside a pool millipede with its little legs all curled up. Fascinating. It's really, really fascinating to see. And just to finish up with what I was saying before I got distracted by the exoskeleton of the pool millipede, there's this insect known as a bagworm, which collects all of this kind of rubbish, gathers it around it, and essentially, unless you see it moving, you wouldn't know that there's an insect within that. It basically creates its own little, I don't know what you'd call it, it's almost like a disguise. It creates its own little disguise that it moves through. And as I one last look at this phenomenally camouflaged grasshopper. Chris Applegate, you wanted to know a little bit about how you can tell the difference between male and female grasshoppers and a little bit about how they reproduce. So from what I understand about most of our species of grasshopper, and I'm saying most of them because within our insect world there are inevitably exceptions to it, but for these particular types of grasshopper you won't be able to tell the difference between male and female clearly unless you can really go about investigating them. And then, like all insects, their reproductive parts all stored internally, almost very similar to the structure of a bird, but obviously with the open hemisyl of the insect, so that open blood cavity. I don't actually know all that much about the courting of grasshoppers. I don't think I've ever read into it. I'd be fascinating to learn a bit more. From what I understand, it's pretty much a free-for-all. And there's different techniques different techniques of attracting a mate, and the stridulations between the legs, or the legs rubbing, for example, maybe colorful displays. I'm not sure about the grasshoppers. But since we are on essentially ground level, Natasha's asked a very salient point. Now, Natasha, you were wondering, what are the animals eating? What greenery are the animals eating from this perspective? The odd green shoot is still around. Not much. I mean, this is not a species of grass that yields a very high nutritional content. You can tell just by looking at it. Very, very defensive mechanisms. The fur on the outside helping to detract from the water loss that the drought has caused. That fuzz and fur that we see along the new shoots. But there's not much, to be honest, Natasha. It's amazing the way in which animals are actually able to eke out a living out of what's left of the grass and the greenery. Now, this is in the middle of our wet season, where we should be walking around. We actually probably wouldn't be able to see sites like this if it was actually as rainy and as nutritious as it should have been this year. VM and I would be sitting probably up to head height in grass species. That's what we should have around us. Natasha, these things are what's going to save the animals, the tree species. The trees are capable of reaching down into the lower levels of the soil, tapping into the nutrients and the moisture that the soils manage to protect from evaporation effects. And it's the trees that will essentially help it to survive. It is one of those crazy things. I've never seen the bush like this, personally. I've never seen the bush look like this in February. Whoop, I nearly fell over. VM got up much more gracefully than I did in that moment. Now, cast your mind back to the midden I asked you about, and let's see if you can guess what it is. Now, a few of you. Now, lots of you were guessing that it was rabbit poop, or in this case, since we don't have any rabbits wandering around the area, scrub hair poop. I'm going to show you what scrub hair poop looks like. It's a good answer. It was a very, very good suggestion, but I've actually just found some, so I'll show you. Now, this is what scrub hair dung looks like. Notice how pale it is in color. I'm not going to really talk about the shape because it's almost the same. Rough in texture, but it is a little bit more round than the other midden. But what's important is the color of scrub hair dung. It's what sets it apart from all the other dung species, or all the other species leaving their dung around here. And there's lots, I must say, there's definitely an area highly populated by scrub hairs. I'm just looking around me now. Well, well done to James Robinson and Safari Dean, as well as Siberia Zumi and Lucy. You guys all got it spot on. It was, from what I could tell, it was a dung midden of a grey dacre or a common dacre. So that's exactly what the answer I was looking for. The only other thing that we could possibly confuse it with, apart from scrub hair, which I'm coming back to, I haven't finished talking about the scrub hair yet, but let's talk about that midden since we saw it. Very often, The only other antelope you could confuse it with in terms of the size of the dung is probably a steenbok. But as our regular viewers know, most of the time, not all of the time, but most of the time, the steenbok at least make a sort of a passable effort at covering their dung, even if it's just, for example, the odd token scrape of their back foot over the top. So you usually see those scrape marks, even if they haven't succeeded in covering their dung completely. Whereas with grey dacre, they actually don't bother, the common dacre. There's one other animal that it could be, but the habitat is wrong and the chances of it is so slim. And that's a Sharp's Crazebok. So it's an interesting combination of guessing and it's an educated guess. It's basically deciding what it is most likely to be. It could be a Sharp's Crazebok. The smallest antelope species you're going to see out here, and if you see one, I can guarantee that the presenter concerned will be beside themselves with excitement. Sorry, just checking out what I thought was movement. Nothing serious. One more point. Scrub, I'll get back to your scrub hair. In the meantime, let's figure out what Scott is up to.
Zoom in onto the end of my finger. No, the end of my finger. Right on the end of my finger. Hallelujah! The grey-hooded kingfisher! Finally! And it's got a kill. I hope Mike in Florida is watching. We have been trying so hard for this bird. And finally, we've got it. And it's got a kill. It's got a massive grasshopper, and there it goes. A beautiful tinge of blue. It has landed. If you zoom out, I'll be able to guide you in again. It's just in there. There, just on the end of my finger. It's behind a bit of a branch. You can just see a blue. Are you fully zoomed in?
Yeah.
You can just see, let me roll back a bit. There you go. You can see a bit of that bright blue, that chestnut belly, and its gray head. There we go. Look at how awesome the blue is on its back. So different to the blue of other kingfishers in this area. And who knows, maybe, if we're lucky, and a big reason why I don't think it's swallowed that kill yet is it may have a nest nearby. Where did it go? I didn't see where it flew off. It was too quick. Nikki seems to think she can see it, but I don't think so, Nix. I think it's hasta la vista. But we got it! Finally, the grey-hooded kingfisher. I'll show it to you guys in the book now quickly. It's one that's been avoiding us the whole summer. It is a migrant, and that is a great new bird for the bird lists. So you'll notice here in the picture, very distinct chestnut belly and that dark blue on the back. So out of all of the birds on this whole page now, the only one we're missing is this one here, the half-collared kingfisher. I've seen a handful of sightings of them in the Sabi Sands, but along the Sand River. They do rely on water, as do the malachite kingfishers. But the other three on this page, none of them rely on water. The woodlands, the African pygmy and the grey-headed kingfisher are all bushveld kingfishers that eat insects. Well, that was awesome, and I'm glad we've finally captured it. No ways, it is still here. Nikki was right. Just right on there. Is it more to the right? No, further right there. Keep going right. There we go. Awesome. It's busy killing the grasshopper before it swallows it. It is a massive, massive grasshopper. Well, Justin and Lynn, you guys are racing ahead on your bird lists into your hundreds, and Therese has just got a 218th bird. I'm not sure there's many of you that are in the 200 marker, but well done. And he's just swallowed it, or she. Hard to distinguish between male and female of the species. And obviously that was its own breakfast. They nest in cavities in riverbanks or termite mounds. So they don't nest in cavities in trees like the woodlands kingfisher. Although sometimes I'm told they might. I just wanted to fly. Excuse me. Excuse me, sorry. And naturally, you cough directly downwards onto your chest, which is exactly where the lapel mic is, so you guys would have got that very loudly. I think it still might be in my throat. Anyway. Goodbye, little grey-headed kingfisher. Thank you for finally gracing us with your presence. It's been a long time coming. You've been dodging us. I just got the fly out my mouth. That's evidence that I wasn't lying. Shame I don't think it's alive anymore. Anthony Liverpool, and happy that we can celebrate your 6-month anniversary, safari anniversary, with us at the moment. And is this the first time you're chatting with us in 6 months? I know there's a lot of you who are sitting there silently all around the world, not communicating with us, and a lot of the time the reason for that is that you say we've already answered the questions, and that's great news, but still, just let us know what's going on. Let us know that you're out there. We love to know whoever is on our vehicle, naturally. So please, even if it's not a question, if it's just a hello, if you just give us a weather update from whatever strange part of the world you may be in, we would appreciate that. Now, Anthony, while I've been rambling on about everything else other than your question, I've completely forgot what you wanted to know. So I'm just going to wait for Nikki to remind me. Well, oh, the humble, the worldwide pigeon. The humble worldwide pigeon, you call it, or flying rats is another word, I think, to describe them. I have only ever seen one flying through the Sabi Sands before. So no, we don't really get them here, but we do get them in all of the cities of South Africa. Those feral pigeons, we call them. But only once ever have I seen one in the Sabi Sands. It's too pure and too natural out here for the feral pigeons to occur. But we do get one pigeon we do get here is quite opposite to the feral pigeon, and it's actually called the parrot pigeon or parrot dove. But that is only if you directly translate the Afrikaans word for it, which is called a papagaai, Dave. A papagaai is a parrot in Afrikaans, which is a language of mainly Dutch descent. Where are we looking here? Dove, 6062. There we go. So here are the doves. You get lots of different types of doves in this general area, but here we specifically get the laughing dove, the Cape Turtle dove, the Emerald Spotted Wood dove. We don't really get the African Mourning, the Red Eye too much, although you could see them here, or the Tambourine. I'm going to page over. Speckled Pigeon, also known as a Rock Pigeon, I've never seen in the Sabi Sands. They do, like their former name, the Rock Pigeon, require rocky outcrops. They like nesting and roosting there. This is an awesome bird, the Namaqua dove. We do see them from time to time here. The male's got a long tail. They're exceptionally small birds, though. But finally, this is the pigeon that we do get here, the one and only pigeon, the papagaai dove. And isn't that very parrot-like? And on an overcast day like this, we may get lucky and actually see one sitting on a dead tree. They like to sun themselves in the early mornings, but mainly in winter when it's cold, you'll get your best sightings of these birds. Otherwise, they're quite secretive and they like to spend their time in the canopies of trees where they're feeding on fruits. So there we go, Anthony. But yes, I think feral pigeons occur worldwide, but mainly in cities. They prefer the concrete jungles. Hello, Easy. You would like to... have us find you a European bee eater because you love the colors of them. Look at its long tongue there. Awesome. Her long tongue, rather. It's not an it, it's a her. It's a lady. Izzy, I would love to find you some European bee eaters. They are around at the moment, but they're usually not the most obliging of birds.
when it comes to viewing them, but they do have incredible colorations. What we may be able to do a little bit later is try and swing past the quarantine clearings. I saw a carmine bee eater sitting there yesterday. So that we will try and do. I'm trying to check what tree that is she was feeding on. It looked like it could have been a tamboti. And it's a toxic tree, the tamboti, although animals will from time to time feed on them. And especially giraffe. I've also noticed when they do feed on them, that they can salivate profusely. She's just eyeballing us through a hole in the center of those trees over there. Look at that. Awesome. It does look like she has got a bit of a strange walk going on. I'm not sure if she's lame in some way, if she's got a stone in her, in between her hooves. Hard to be certain. Or if it was just some uneven ground that she was walking over, she seemed to have a bit of a swagger. Let's see what she's feeding on now, if it's another tamboti tree. Yeah, it is. No ways! I've never seen a giraffe do that. Look at how she's using her mouth to bend the tree. I'm going to try and roll forward a bit more to bend the tree down, and that will be able to access the leaves a little bit more easily. That was so cool. I'm not sure if you managed to see. I'm sure you did, though. She kind of gripped the branch in her mouth and bent it downwards. And I've never, ever seen a giraffe doing that. So, interesting, though, like I said, at this time of the year, or maybe because it's a drought, they're resorting to the tamboti, or maybe she's self-medicating. But not many animals will ever feed on this tree. Even if we as humans use the wood to cook on, it can make you violently ill. If you are to drink the sap, it can also make you violently ill to the point that you die. But interestingly enough, the local Shangaan people will occasionally make a diluted concoction of this that they will drink and then spend hours vomiting and pooing to clean their system and sweating. It's like a forced 24 hours of hell in order to completely flush your system. And it's quite interesting, a lot of the African cultures do believe in purging the systems completely, whether by drinking tamboti sap or drinking liters of salt water from the sea. They are fans of induced pain in order to cleanse their systems, which is just quite interesting culturally. Well, sadly, I don't think we're going to be seeing any more of that lady. She has dissolved into the thickets. One animal that can feed on the tamboti and does feed on it quite readily is the porcupine, Africa's largest rodent. And you'll often see where they chew on the bark at the base of the trees. Joey, aka the monkey man, made a monkey-like move and deleted his whole bird list. He was on 89, and apologies, monkey man, that's terrible news. And well, at least you've got grouted kingfisher. I mean, that's a good one. The other 89 we can get easily, but that one there is tricky. But we'll get back up to scratch. I'm sure you can remember a lot of them, though. I'm guessing that you can just, you know, scribble down without cheating yourself. That is also accepted within the ornithological world. But apologies to hear that. Maybe a hard copy together with a soft copy is the way forward. The ground is very hard here, but I'm still just poking my head out every now and then just to see if we can't get lucky. Some of you may remember this area, as it is a place where the Inkahuma pride of lions called the buffalo not very long ago. It was just off to our right where they were feeding on it. And I'm just checking now to see if there's... Oh, yeah, there's one or two bones in there. Let's see if we can't find the skull. I'll stop here, though, and David will be able to show you where some of the vertebrae are. There we go. And I'm going to just do a quick scout around to see if I can't find you the skull. Before I do that, though, I'm going to put my little lapel mic receiver up on the dash. Come on, work well for us. Just making sure there's nothing that wants to squash me in the nearby vicinity. Everything appears okay for now. It always fascinates me how such large portions of a carcass can simply disappear from the kill sites. I mean, the skull and horns of a buffalo are heavy. Oh, looks like the hyenas have been hard at work here. I'm going to bring you a jawbone that I've just picked up. Well, what remains of it. No sign of the skull. I'm guessing that this will be from the bottom jaw. That's typically the skull or the part of the skull that does get consumed, but the upper portion of the skull is harder to chew through. The skull cannot be seen. Go away, bird. Wah! Calling behind us, probably shouting at me, actually. So here's a portion of, I'm guessing, the lower jawbone that's been broken and chewed in all likelihood by hyena, the bone crushers of the African wilderness. So that's quite useful. If anybody needs a false tooth, let me know and I'll pluck one out of here for you. Eh? Might be a bit big, but you can get it whittled down to size by your dentist. Wouldn't that be a little war story there? Okay, I'm going to get rid of this now and show you something else. I don't know if this is going to work as well as I want it to. Ooh, it might. So this is the spinal cord. And I was hoping I was going to be able to look all the way down it, which I think is still possible. I just need to reposition one thing. And then we'll be able to see where the whole spinal column went. Just about, you can, well, yes, I can see your eye. So you can maybe just see mine through that cavity. But I'm spying on you through there, and that's where the spinal cord runs. Integral part of every mammal's anatomy, the spinal cord, because as soon as that breaks, like that, the spinal cord, which runs through that hole, is severed, and then you're in trouble. Very good. Sometimes you just got to give the go-away birds their own medicine. Put them in place. Okay, we're going to continue through the Marikeni riverbed. Hopefully we're going to maybe find the Anderson male leopard, a monster of a male leopard who we haven't seen for quite some time. He lurks through these areas. And while we do that, you guys are going back to the bushwalk with Jamie.
And I'm currently breaking a cardinal rule of walking in the bush, so please don't emulate or try and copy this. And the reason I say that is we're right at the entrance to an active burrow, and I will preface this by saying that I've been really, really careful. We've all been really careful in our approach to this. This is definitely somebody's home, and it's interesting to investigate it. There are lots, or at least when we first arrived, I'm just thinking about war dogs coming shooting out of here. Vim and myself will go flying into the drainage line that's behind us. Very quickly. Probably not as quickly as the warthog that could come running out of here. Now, we've spoken about this before, about how dangerous it is to sit right at the entrance to a burrow. Personally, I don't think it's a warthog burrow. I could be wrong about that. I'd prefer not to be wrong about that, but I think I'm right. There's lots and lots of flies. There's very clear, fresh signs of excavation. And what I've been trying to figure out or try to look at is whether or not there's any tracks. There's another entrance just down there. You can see what I mean when I said that VM and I would go tumbling down into the drainage line. Now, for new viewers, warthogs tend to back into their burrows, and they do like burrows like this in termite mounds. So a warthog will back up into a tunnel, and when I say that they can probably explode out of there at roughly sort of the speed and with about the same amount of sound as one of the Apollo missions in terms of their takeoff, they shoot out so fast and you just get dust and noise. And I know I'm not the only guide who's ever had a heart attack thanks to warthogs suddenly coming out of burrows. And it's very dangerous. They've got very, very sharp tushes, those lower tusks, not the big nice curly ones, but the lower tushes that are sharpened by constant rubbing against the top ones. They can be incredibly dangerous. That being said, and having discussed that and having come to the conclusion, and VM being incredibly trusting of that assessment in standing where we are, I think it's not a warthog. Gives us a couple of options. It could be an aardvark, but they aren't the usual fly species. There's a very pale species of fly that tend to hang around only outside aardvark burrows. I haven't seen any of those, and I haven't seen any tail drag marks. What quite often happens when you look at an entrance to an aardvark burrow, often they rest along the side and you get just a drag, pretty much like a drag mark, that sits and often moves then down into the burrow itself. It sort of looks like this. I don't think we're looking at an aardvark burrow. My suspicion would be porcupine. I think that is the consensus as to what this might be. It'd be interesting to get hold of Brent's camera trap and try and confirm that that is actually the case. Hold on. I've just said that about the fly species and I've just spotted one. I think it could be an aardvark. I've changed my mind completely. Sorry. 180 degrees. These are one of the species of flies that move around outside aardvark, active aardvark burrows, and I think that's what we've got here. So maybe this particular aardvark just didn't want to drag his tail. Interesting. I was going to say porcupine, I was going to say freshly excavated porcupine. I've just changed my mind. I think that it could be a freshly excavated aardvark. Interesting. We may actually never know unless we put a camera trap up. But this is very, very fresh, and you can actually see the power of this animal that's dug and excavated under this termite mound, flicking the mounds of sand up like this and excavating an enormous amount of soil that's out of here onto this mound. And then down from this entrance and into the drainage line itself. Okay, I've changed my mind. Ooh, there is a chance that you might see the ground suddenly spinning towards you at a very rapid rate.
Your YouTube button's ready.
Yes, have your YouTube buttons ready. As we go, both VM and myself at risk of tumbling down into the drainage line. It's very loose soiled. And now the soil's all in my shoe. I'm stuck there. It's the one disadvantage of this particular style of shoe, is it tends to collect dirt but doesn't really let it go. Maybe we are looking at an aardvark burrow. You can see the power with which this thrust into the drainage line. Oh, being very brave. Yeah, I'll pop the torch in. Huh? Now we were just, while you were with Scott, we were actually just discussing the merits versus the disadvantages of the drought in terms of our walks. So X-Ranger, you wanted to know if there would be bushwalks if the grass was as high as it should be. And we're actually stuck here. I don't think we can manage to navigate our way out of it. But if we look at the view that we have at the moment, Ex-Ranga, there would still be bushwalks. There would probably be, we might move a little bit slower. We definitely would have a wider variety of insect life to show you. At the moment, the insect yield of this particular year has been negligible compared to what it should be. So we'd have lots of exciting insects, lots of interesting things like that to show you. Our visibility isn't as good. So we can't see as far, which essentially means you've got to take a little bit more care in terms of how you walk through the bush. Just in terms of listening, just taking it a little bit slower because you don't have that opportunity to see a threat ahead of time. Whereas at the moment, it's like winter. We can actually see 100 meters into the bush at times, which is a perfectly safe distance at which to see an animal and then decide upon whether you're going to move away or approach. So it's definitely, it's an interesting one. There would be bushwalks. We'd have more to show you and we'd have less to show you. It's one of those strange things. It's worked to the advantage in its own way. I'm not quite sure how I'm going to make my way out of here. Ooh. Oh well, we'll have a look at the entrance for now. Since Jen B has asked a question about porcupines, which is essentially, how do they go in and how do they go out? How do they reverse in and out? And Jen, the answer is, unlike warthogs, they will go head first in, and they will often have a sort of a turning space within their burrow itself that they've constructed and excavated so that they can turn around and come out face forward. It's amazing the way that they get around the complications of the quills, because I can see what you're thinking about. If you've got quills that have gone in and then you start to back out, they're gonna at some point get stuck. But of course, the quills lying flat, they can reverse out. And it makes the most sense to have your most dangerous end facing the threat. So for warthog, it's the front with the tusks. For porcupines, it's the back end with the quills. Now, interestingly, quite often you see with porcupines and their den sites is they often bring quills back to the den site or where they are. And B. Wilson, you've asked me for something specific. I haven't quite clearly heard exactly what it is, but B. Wilson, I'm going to find out exactly what you wanted to, oh, there we go. Perfect. Okay. B. Wilson would like to see a sort of a cross section of a nest. Well, B. Wilson, I'll keep an eye out for you. Let's see what plan we can make. But first of all, Vim and myself need to navigate our way out of here, and I think it would probably be better if we did that off air in case I tumble down into the drainage line, or Vim tumbles down into the drainage line. So while we escape from our sandy prison, let's pop over and find out what Scott's up to.
Well, interesting stuff over there with Jamie and her burrows. Wouldn't it be nice to know if there was, in fact, an aardvark in there just a few meters away from you guys? We are now in the domain of the Anderson male leopard. He likes to lurk around this large riverbed system that flows off to the right-hand side of where we are here. And he could pop up his head at any stage. Over the radio network, though, I haven't heard any major updates on Arethusa. There doesn't seem to be too much that has been located yet, but that doesn't mean that there are not animals nearby. So, I'm remaining optimistic. It's been a long time since we've seen the Anderson male. And we're basically heading kind of south down the western fringe of Arethusa. We can't go much further west. There's one road that runs parallel to the riverbed on the other side of it here that we can drive along. But this is just about as far west as we can. We'll shortly be popping out at the Arethusa waterhole, which is going to be very interesting because I haven't seen its state of affairs in quite a long time. I haven't seen how much water's left there. So that'll be interesting to see what's going on. I'm sure there is still some water, and hopefully that will be attracting some game. Hello to Derek in New York. You interested to know if there are any updates on another leopard we could bump into here? Shadow, a female. And not that I've heard of, although I forgot to mention, I did find some tracks that I am quite sure might be hers. They were right in the northwestern corner of Juma. It's like the Bermuda Triangle there, so I didn't try and follow up. They were kind of heading towards Sydney's Dam, which is where we had come from after we left, where we saw those zebra drinking. So I thought they were her tracks, judging by the area that they were in. But Derek, you'd like to know a little bit more about her and whether or not there's been any more confirmed updates on whether she has cubs or not, and no confirmed sightings and or updates on that. So again, even though there was speculation that she did have cubs, and I think guys did see her with suckle marks, she too, like her mother, again speculation, may well have lost her cubs. Again, no surprises, and in my career I have seen many leopards, more so, it far outweighs leopards losing cubs far outweighs them raising them. Far. So I think the two of them may have been unlucky, but let's hope that that's not the case. It's just that their behavior has appeared to indicate that they don't have cubs. And the reason why is that if a leopard does have a den, she goes backwards and forwards, and if you've got half decent trackers around, they're going to notice these tracks beelining up and down on the same kind of pathways to the same area. Whereas we haven't had that. Again, it could be through default, they could be moving the den sites often, or it could be the more likely fact that the cubs are no longer. In LA, and you guys have heard of the theory that leopards will lift up their tails kind of high up above their back when they are kind of waving the white flag. They are showing everyone that they're there, they proving a point that they're not trying to creep up on anything. And the reason or the theory behind them doing that is so that they do not creates a lot of alarm calls or attention to them. Obviously a leopard who's going back to den site doesn't want to create a lot of alarm calls and a fuss about that, because it may attract other predators to those alarm calls, like lion or hyena may come and investigate, hey, what's going on here? Why is the general game getting so nervous there? So I have seen that happening. I'm not too convinced about the whole theory. That doesn't make entire sense. I mean, everything knows that a leopard is potentially dangerous. So even though, yes, I have seen them holding up their tails once they have been spotted to kind of acknowledge it, I'm not sure if that's a frustration thing or exactly how it works. I'm basically not convinced by that theory. It doesn't really add up to me, because whether you're a leopard with your tail up or your tail down, animals are gonna panic, you know? So. And I have noticed the same amount of panic and alarm calls when they do hold their tails up. Hello to Ellen in Arkansas. I'd like to know if there's any plants or anything really that animals could feed on that would cause their behavior to be strange, or any major kind of upsets. And not that I've ever seen. It is possible though, like I said earlier with the giraffe, I mean, one thing I've noticed with the giraffe that was feeding on Timbuti was that it had an incredibly long trail of saliva trailing out of its mouth. It was probably like half a meter long. Obviously, with the giraffe having such a long neck, there's no risk of the saliva touching the ground or anything really. So there's long trails of saliva coming out of the mouth, but the behavior wasn't any different. So it was just that it was salivating.
What am I not thinking about? What may induce some kind of interesting behavior when animals feed on a certain substance? I'm coming up with a blank, Ellen. But that's not to say that there aren't a few plants that do have some interesting effects on the animals out here. Update for one particular viewer, Easy, who was wanting to see a European bee-eater earlier, and there's apparently one on the Juma waterhole cam, and obviously we don't like to send you away from our live safaris, but if you're sending you away to the live waterhole cam for a few seconds to see one of your favorite birds, of course that's not a bad thing. So if you'd like to see that pretty bird, sneak across, but please come back and join us on safari. Oh, it's flown away, so don't bother. But maybe after the drives, it'll be worth investing some time there. Nikki does say it is often on the Juma cam. Interesting information from Jeffrey in Texas. Thank you so much, Jeff, for sending this through. And I was discussing how the local African people quite enjoy purging their systems by feeding on various toxic plants usually. You've mentioned that there's a frog that people in Central America used to lick, or possibly still do lick, in order to purge their systems. So thank you very much for that little nugget of information. There's a frog here called the banded rubber frog. Very pretty frog, black with either red or yellow markings on its back. And that too is also highly toxic. You don't even want to handle that. Perry in the UK, you would like to know what spiders we get. We get all kinds of spiders. Orb web spiders, funnel web spiders, which I think I've just seen a web of. Down to our left, yeah, that does look like a funnel web spider down there. Let me jump out. But you name it, we've got it regarding spiders. Jumping spiders, big spiders, small spiders. We've got a spider like a tarantula called the baboon spider. Oh yeah, this is really cool. I'm not sure if you can see the funnel from there. Can you see the little hole, Dave? Not really in here. You can see all the webbing. You might just be able to see the small hole. And I actually did see the spider. It's sitting in there. Well, it was. As I approached, it disappeared. I might be able to simulate a bug being caught though, and it might be able to lure it back out by just touching a little portion of the web here and shaking like a butterfly. It may work. No joy. So there's a spider for you, the funnel web spider. I think I'm in your way. Anyway, I don't think we're gonna get a good view of it. But there we go. Many, many different types of spiders though. And one of the best places to see spiders is on the bushwalk. And I'm sure Nikki is gonna tell them to keep their eye out for any spiders for you. Steph, who's on the bushwalk with Jamie, is a spider fanatic. He loves them, especially jumping spiders. He goes bananas when he sees them.
And I think it was yesterday morning, yes, it was yesterday morning, that James found a garden orb-web spider, a beautiful spider, quite a large spider. Sadly, we don't have as many orb-web spiders out this summer as we usually do, and that's due to the drought entirely, I think. There's not as many insects around to feed them, so they've been growing very slowly. But usually they're very large spiders. Well, maybe that's legs included. They're quite spindly, but they're large. And their nests are a beautiful golden coloration, very, very strong webbing. Anna Marie, thank you for your wishful thinking with the hope that we're going to find the Anderson male. This is the place where it can happen. The first time I saw him was just a little bit further behind where we are now, but he often lurks through this very, very area. So it's highly possible that we will get lucky now, Anna Marie, and apologies that you haven't seen him yet. To be honest, the two times I've seen him, the first sighting was pretty cool, but it was very short-lived. He was lying down as we got there, got up, and then walked off within minutes. But it was a beautiful scene, but short. Quality, not quantity, though. Then the second sighting was one of the biggest letdowns of my guiding career. I was responding to a sighting with both Tingana and the Anderson male, who were allegedly having some kind of a debate. When we got there, they were kind of hardly acknowledging one another. You could hear Tingana very, very, very softly growling. But it was a letdown. It was a massive letdown. And they basically just slept next to one another, and we could hardly see the Anderson male where he was sleeping. Okay, now I've got some sad news for sensitive viewers. I would suggest maybe closing one ear and one eye. This is very tragic, what I'm about to show you. Now, if you look below here on the ground, you can see what used to be a mud wallow. And it's completely bone dry. No more water. Sad for whatever may have wanted to wallow here. The warthogs, the buffalo, whatever may have wanted to drink here also. Unfortunate times. But more importantly, if we look above me, these animals are the ones that are going to have the worst outcome. This is the foam nest of a foam nest frog. I'm just going to touch it gently. Oh, foamy. I'll actually bring a little bit back with me, because the bottom line is that whatever tadpoles would have hatched in there and then plummeted out of the sky down into what was once a wallow is now no longer. So they would have just landed in the dust, or had they have not landed in the dust, maybe they landed in the water that shortly thereafter dried up. So, sad reality. What's interesting is that the female foam nest frog will beat her legs together as she secretes this kind of liquid that turns into foam, and she'll have up to like five or six, even more sometimes, males clambering all over her, and then they will be the ones that are, how could I have forgotten this word, doing something to the eggs, making the eggs fertile, fertilizing the eggs is what I'm trying to get at. Late night last night, obviously. And this is the foam that those eggs will develop in. It's quite interesting. I've actually never felt it before. No ways. It's like candy floss. Feel that, Dave. It's literally just like candy floss. So that's where the eggs would have been developing. Obviously, once the tadpole is big enough, it then falls out of the foam and then disappears, well, falls into the water, which is hopefully below it. But in this case, that wasn't to be. Sorry, froggies. Drought's not doing you any good, eh? So, the candy floss nest frog, or foam nest frog. Julian in Connecticut, good day and good to have you with us. You've interested to work out how is it that leopards and lion, who both have high mortality rates of the young, and I guess cheetah even as well, how do they actually manage to survive and have a decent population if they lose so many young? It's a good point, but I guess it just emphasizes that it's survival of the fittest, you know, and unless it's really meant to be, predators will not make it. And that does make sense, because if we had predators around every corner, there would not be enough food to sustain them. It just simply wouldn't be sustainable. And there also wouldn't be enough space for them. There wouldn't be enough territory for them. I mean, if we think of all of the leopard cubs that get lost, if those weren't to get lost, I mean, there'd just be a leopard in every tree we drove around here. Considering how long they can live for, considering how much they need to eat, you know, it makes sense that all of the young don't survive in terms of populations and the sustainability of things. And again, like I said, it also just ensures that only the strongest genes are getting through. Often it's male leopard are the number one killers of leopard cubs. And that ensures that only the dominant male who's really staked claim to an area will be able to have his cubs, make sure there's no other intruding males at the time. And then those cubs will be the ones that make it through, again, if they're lucky enough to be killed, not be killed by hyena or lion. But if you look at the Sabi Sands, I mean, we've got a very, very healthy leopard population here, a great leopard population. And there's, obviously, everyone would like a few more leopards on their property, but in reality, there's plenty of leopards around. And all of these leopards, all of these females, or many females, lose lots of cubs. So it's just the kind of way it is, I guess. It's the way of the wild. Apologies. A little bit of an intercontinental difference here in terms of what we call our different sweets. Here in South Africa, we call candy floss that substance that gets put on a stick, usually at fun fairs. Maybe you call a fun fair a carnival, not sure, but you call it cotton candy, not candy floss. So there we go. We call ketchup tomato sauce as well. That's another difference here in South Africa. Any others that you can think of, Dave? Major differences? I've put you on the spot, but that's because I can't think of any others. Chips and fries, soda. We don't call soda really. We call them fizzy drinks because of the bubbles. So we don't really call them soda too much. We call it either a Coke or a Fanta. We don't call it a soda so much. What else? Yeah, we'll keep thinking about it. Oh, bonnet hood. We call the front of a vehicle the bonnet. You call it the hood. And an obvious South African one. We call our traffic lights robots. What next? Makes perfect sense to us until we actually think about it. It looks nothing like I guess it could look something like a robot. But a robot without any arms or legs. And its only function is to flash light. Gas and petrol, that's another one. We don't call it gas, we call it petrol. And in South Africa, we don't have to fill up our own gas. You put into a petrol station or a gas station, and there are people there that put the fuel into your car. So that's another difference between here and the States. Good, well, I'm about to take Dave to the Arethusa Dam, and we'll let you know if there's anything there when we get there. The first view he is going to have of that area and the lodge, and we're going to send you over to Jamie on our way there.
So I think in the cotton candy floss, cotton, what's it called again? Now I've completely lost what we call it. Candy floss. Candy floss versus cotton candy. I think that VM's got it absolutely right. The best name is the Afrikaans name for it. Spook awesome, ghost's breath. I think that's a perfect example of good naming, appropriate naming, although apparently ghosts have very, very sweet breath. But you can see it. You can see the crystallization, the idea behind it. It's much more of a descriptive name. You'll notice I'm keeping an eye out sort of towards my right. The reason I'm doing that is because I've noticed a lot of oxpeckers moving across. Now, oxpeckers, for those of you who don't know, are a really, really important sign and sound of the bush, because they sit on animals like buffalo. They also sit, of course, on giraffe and on kudu. In this particular case, it was a big male kudu that they were attracted to. Oh, there's his track, actually. Oh, there's a smaller kudu's track. This can't be the large male that I was looking at. And look here. Just talking about the stuff that you can learn from tracks. Here's his track here, moving in this towards me in this direction. Look how it's flicked. I wonder whether or not that kudu was running. Usually quite indicative of an animal moving quickly. Although sometimes they drag their feet, just like we sometimes do when we get lazy. But it's amazing the number of different, just to go on to a different sub. Oh no, let me finish off with my oxpeckers. So oxpeckers are really an important sound to listen out for in the bush. They can give away the position of an animal really, really clearly. And that's important when you're walking through, because 80% of the time you are going to hear something before you see it out here. Okay, this is a bit different in this particular season and the way that, or how dry it is and the amount of visibility that we have. But it's always very, very important to listen to the sounds of the bush and what it's telling you. Now we know, we've seen buffalo multiple times, and the number of oxpeckers that sit on them. I have a nice idea. Since we're here, should we go pop into the old hyena den and investigate what's happening there? Now, I would investigate on foot, regardless of whether or not it would be active. Oh my word, I've got an entourage of flies. Now, the hyenas are very, very comfortable with people on foot. You don't constantly move about a den site on foot. They're much more comfortable with the vehicle. But finding an active den site on foot and exploring it is actually a really nice, it's probably the only way of finding an active den. This is the old Gallagher shortcut den. You can see already evidence of a time when hyenas inhabited this place. You can really actually nicely see the hollow where hyenas managed to break open this bone and get to the bone marrow inside. And that, of course, is what they are specifically adapted to be able to do. Crunching, that power of that jaw. It's the reason that their neck and their shoulders are structured like that. Now, we're just going to stroll our way towards the old den site. And while we do, Scott has made his way to the Arethusa Dam. So let's find out what's come down to drink.
So we've just arrived at the Arethusa waterhole, and there is a marabou stork, one of the less fortunate looking birds, at least less fortunate looking storks, but the good news is it's hunting. And we may see it catch a frog or a catfish in what little moisture remains at the Arethusa waterhole. I'm not shocked, but surprised to see how dry it has become, and as Dave zooms out, you'll get a good idea of just how little water remains here. And due to the dissipating amounts of water, the hippos have also disappeared, all but one. I can see one. There may be more in here. And the one that is here, there's the camp. For those of you who are new to safari life, this is Arethusa. Wouldn't that be a nice spot to stay? Views overlooking where we are here. The hippos just out in the thickness there. Dave will show you exactly where it is. Just behind this little stump sticking out of the water. You can just see a little, what looks to be a rock there. That is a hippopoto rock. So I'm not sure where all the other hippos would have gone to, but that is the reality of the drought. There's a few different antelope species around here as well. We've got some kudu, some inyala. The kudu are the lighter species and more gray, and the inyala are the rusty and chocolate brown colored ones at the back. So two of the spiral horned antelopes, and then further to the left, there's a massive herd of
Impala. And they all scattered about over there, and then even further left of them is a lone waterbuck bull who's enjoying just chilling out on the open clearing. So, now one of you, I didn't catch your name too clearly, but I'll get reminded of it now, is interested to know if a crocodile can survive without the end of its nose, as the crocodile fight has escalated and it sounds like the big crocodile has removed the end of the small crocodile's nose. Sabrina, who's just 12 years old, it's hard to say. It sounds like quite a bad injury, to be honest, so I'm not feeling too hopeful that it will survive, but we must always remember that these animals never, never, never give up, and they're very, very tough, so it is possible that maybe, just maybe, it will survive. And some strange things do happen out here in nature, and against all odds, some animals may survive. What are these kudu looking at? You don't mind zooming into them? Is it the marabou stork? Or is there something else, like a snake possibly? Look how it's changed posture now. What's happening here? Look at the way the kudu even now, it's coming closer to investigate. Let's go and have a look. I'm hoping it's seen a snake. Possibly a monitor lizard though. I don't know, or maybe it's just this marabou stork. It's not making sense to me. But this kudu is nervous of something here. I'm not sure if it is looking beyond. No, it's looking right down there on the ground. What have you seen? Ah, there's something amiss here. Just scanning my binoculars. If I can't see anything more, I'm going to jump off and have a closer look on foot. Maybe they're just panicking though. Maybe they're looking at a little rock here behind this dead tree that's making them feel like there's a predator. Obviously, as they get close to the water's edge, which they're heading towards, they will become more and more nervous. So I think it's that. There's also a bit of a breeze picking up now. I think the combination of the breeze and the fact that they're at the water's edge is what's causing them to be nervous. Now, the problem at this time of the year and during a drought, or even in the winter season, is that when antelope try and drink, they need to get through a thick layer of mud before they get to the water's edge and can sometimes become stuck. It is something that I can almost guarantee is going to happen at some point. And I'm not sure whether intervening is the right thing to do, stealing an easy meal away from the predators. I'd be inclined not to intervene, although some people do intervene in these circumstances. Oh, look, the ones on the left there are kind of, I think, beginning to get into some softer mud. Yeah, you can see it's going to start sinking in, and it might come out with dark. Dark socks. Looks at least like they're getting a little bit of moisture there, so that's good news. I don't think they're going to get stuck. They're not disappearing too deep into the mud either, so that's good. Yeah, they're definitely getting some water there, and it looks like they're not going to get stuck just yet. Just got a comment through from Tony, who's watching on YouTube. And Tony, isn't it remarkable just how big those ears are, like you say, especially in relation to their heads? like massive satellite receivers. And that's because kudu being browsers often live in thick vegetation. So evolutionary, it's made sense to have good hearing. Not that they've got bad eyesight, because often hearing their prey is going to be more effective than possibly seeing their prey. But well spotted, it is certainly a characteristic of the kudu. Hello to James Taylor, who remembered when he was growing up that the storks were often used to deliver babies. And yes, the same thing happens here in South Africa. So interesting how that has spread, at least from where you are to where we are here. But that certainly was the case. I'm not too sure whether it's still applicable or applied to the younger generations of South Africa, but it certainly was the case when I was growing up. Very good. Bye-bye, kudu and one inyala. The rusty colored individual in the middle of them there. There's the old waterbuck chewing the cud on the left. Oh, there he goes. And yes, there are big antelope. The waterbuck grease, look at it go. And it's not the biggest antelope we get in South Africa. That is the eland, which we sadly do not see. Sorry. Hold on, I just heard a very interesting update. Last station, could you go again with the update on that skunk hunt, please?
Good morning, Scott. They are tortured now. I'm close to Mkoro.
Okay, copy. Good luck. Enjoy.
Here.
Sadly, we cannot go there, but there's a cheetah just east of Juma, lying on a termite mound, which got me very excited. I thought the initial update that I got made it sound like it could have been on the southern boundary of Juma. So the greater kudu weighs up to 250 kilos, the male. Okay, so that's the largest antelope that we get you. I'm just having a quick look now for the waterbuck. I'm not sure, I've forgotten how much they weigh. I'm guessing it's not going to be too far behind that. Yeah, 250 to 270. So the waterbuck and the kudu are kind of tie largest, but if anything, the waterbuck can get slightly larger. So the waterbuck will be the largest in this area, then the kudu, but the largest that we can see in Southern Africa is the eland, which will be up into the 400, 500, 600 kilogram mark. They are ginormous, they're like cows. Let me actually double check how big those eland gets, because it could probably even be bigger than what I've just said. 700 to 900 kilograms, the males, almost a ton. Very good, that guy's just enjoying chewing the cud now, making sure he digests his food very well. I could certainly learn a lesson from the antelope. I don't chew my food nearly enough before swallowing it. Jamie did say that she was going to be heading off to the old hyena den to look for any fossils and artifacts. So why don't you guys go over and see what she's managed to find?
Hyena den definitely not active at the moment, but plenty of signs that the hyenas were around at some point, which obviously we know, but it'd be interesting from a perspective of, let's say, we were finding this for the first time. And I've noticed a couple of little bones lying around, not too much in the way of dung, or scat actually would be the correct terminology, That's because generally, for the most part, you don't see them defecating around their den site, or at least close to the den site, unless it's a young cub. Generally, they will tend to defecate, not even necessarily leave the burrow at a young age to go out and defecate. So you don't often find them necessarily at the den site itself, but of course they have latrines. And quite often you can follow and look at the way that latrines are gathered around the den site and along the regularly used pathways. And what was interesting about this den and the way in which the hyenas approached it, when we first started visiting, they generally used the game paths to the south of us. But as soon as the road started to develop, where people were coming in and out of the den site, they started using that. Hyenas love, much like all of the animals, love to use roads. And before I put it down, it is desperately trying to escape. Oh, that's unfortunate.
I hope it didn't follow me.
Oh, that's so sad. Where's my... Oh, there it is. Here we go. That wasn't terribly coordinated on my part, or in fact the tick's part. Come here, tick. Relax, I'm not going to eat you. I promise you that, I'm not going to eat you. Not staying very still, but there you go, that's what I was trying to show you. Okay, I give up. That tick doesn't want to be seen. It's a really pretty one as well. Let's try one more time. Should we just approach it from that? I think Vian's got the right idea. There you go. Looks like probably a little, not a bont tick, maybe one of the red ticks. Ouch. And definitely one of the ticks that you'd find on multiple species. Here we go. Stopped for a moment and you can get an idea of the coloration and pattern. Not an insect that I would say is, I would ever thought I would call pretty. But in fact, this is quite an attractive tick as ticks go. Still don't want to find it attached to any body parts. You can really get an idea of those mouth parts and how strong and solid they have to be to get through the thick skins of the animals. So this little tick, wandering around waiting for a host species to pass by that it can climb onto and jump onto and then engorge itself. And depending on what species of tick it is, they have different stages of life cycle. And you know, it really is drizzling on us. It's quite nice. Really nice, cool morning. But yes, depending on the type of tick, we'll either have a one phase, two phase, or three phase life cycle, which is the number of times that it will attach itself to a host species and then drop off, and the number of times it goes through some kind of, not metamorphosis, but what's the word I'm looking for, in terms of its growth. It'll come to me. It will definitely come to me. What we've been trying to do, since we are at the hyena den, is investigate the sort of interconnectedness of the tunnels, because we very often, when we were here, we'd see the cubs, and they mainly used the entrance at the top of the den here, but they very often popped out either on that side or on the other side of the termite mound. Very difficult to see though. I haven't been able to, a lot of the tunnels have collapsed almost completely without the excavations of the cubs. And I've been trying to Viam shone his torch into one side, I went to the other side to try and see if I could see it. Doesn't seem to come through, but we know that they are connected because we've seen the cubs come through and onto the other side. And since we're here, I also thought it might be quite nice. We could never really get the vehicle around to show you the one entrance. And towards the end of their time at this den, the most recent time, they actually moved to the other side. I'm going to show you how nice that and protected that particular entrance is. Well, my hugely unsuccessful attempt to catch that tick while we walk around to the side of the den, Tony wanted to know if you could get sick from those types of tick. And yes, you can. It's not to the same extent as, for example, Lyme disease is a very serious thing within Europe and within the Northern Americas. So you can get Lyme disease from your types of ticks. We personally get something known as tick bite fever. It is a type of bacteria, rickettsia, and it is carried, apparently the statistics are about 1 in 1,000 ticks carries tick bite fever. I've had it. I've also been bitten, I'm fairly certain, well over 1,000, probably close to 5,000 times. I seem to be a bit of a tick magnet. And I've had it once. It hasn't been that serious. Brent had it a little while back, or we think he had it a little while back. Generally, easily treatable. Just a quick course of doxycycline antibiotic, and you're good to go. So they carry a disease, but it's not too serious. I'm looking at this mark in the ground here. and just wondering whether or not they dragged something back. And it's starting to tie together. Remember the Nkuhuma search that we had where we knew that we'd missed a kill? It probably wasn't a huge kill, but we definitely missed a kill within this block. And when we found them again on Impala Road, they were very full-bellied. It was a bit of a competition between Brent and myself, and he shot past me and found them, which I was definitely cheating. They were very full-bellied, and they'd had a kill around here. We were following vultures repeatedly. And I think this is an old drag mark from that carcass. The den site, the active den site, is just about 100 meters to the east of where we are. It's sort of roughly there-ish, in about 100 meters. Interesting. It's all tying together, and that explains why I'm seeing vulture fluff as well. This is the entrance that I was trying to tell you about. You can see this is where they moved to towards the end, and how nice and protected and shaded this particular spot is. It's a perfect hyena den spot. The network of routes and systems, and when the hyenas do decide to move back here, which they will do, hyenas do repeatedly use den sites. When they do decide to move back here, the hyena cubs will be able to excavate their way back into it. Now, this is full of little signs, little chewed bits of wood and twigs. You know how the hyena cubs love to teethe and explore, and they tend to gnaw on the ends of the sticks that they can find, and there's plenty of evidence of that. The other thing that we always associate with the hyena den is the smell, and Tammy wanted to know, does it smell bad? Does it still smell bad? Or has that smell sort of dissipated? I stuck my head into the hole, not quite into the hole, but next to the hole, and I had a good sniff, Tammy, and it doesn't smell nearly as bad as it did without any of the hyenas being around. I know I mentioned that I definitely smelt the fresh smell of death a couple of weeks ago around this den site. So Tammy, it doesn't smell terrible, but there's still the sense that the hyenas were here. I can't describe it. It no longer smells like rotting meat or anything of the sort, but it does, it definitely carries an odor to it. I wanted to show you, I'm trying to look for more of it, back to that drag mark. Remember how we had all of those vultures? I'm just going to go find, I'm going to go back around the side of this den and just show you the vulture down that I spotted. And that's probably because they were using this dead tree as a perch. Angie's on the same page as we are, in a way. Angie has said, wouldn't it be cool, wouldn't it be neat to send the rover down the hyena den tunnel? And Angie, we actually had that conversation about the suspected aardvark burrow that we saw, sending the rover down to explore. I don't know how Graham might feel about that. Perhaps we should ask him. What do you think, Viam? I think we should ask him. I think that is a good use to put it through. Oh, that sounds like something exciting. There's the vulture down that I was looking at, but Scott has got another animal in a tree to show you.
Well, take a look at this. A rock monitor lizard. I'm just using the flashlight to try and illuminate it. Difficult to see, though, and it looks like almost nothing's there. But that's testament to how well camouflaged they are. There, I'm shining the spotlights a bit better now. And he's just taking it easy. He'll live in this cavity, head out and forage. Maybe you've got a number of cavities that it spends its time in. But on a cool day like this, he's probably just waiting for a bit of sunshine to warm up that cold-blooded body before it heads on. Oh, he winked at us. Obviously, we're doing something right. And earlier on, we were chatting about differences of what we may call certain things here in South Africa and what the Americans' viewers may call things. And Bud, thank you very much for highlighting another one that I didn't remember. And that was what we call a torch, you call a flashlight. And quite applicable now, as I am using a flashlight to try and illuminate this rock monitor lizard. It's probably about 3 feet in length, I'm guessing, to give you an idea of what's below in that cavity, about 1.5 feet of which is body, and another 1.5 feet length of tail. They've got a very big bulbous head compared to their cousin, the Nile monitor lizard, and that's one way of distinguishing them, a much more robust head, as well as less bright colorations, though more dull and bland than their water-dwelling cousin. Let's see if we can't get you a little bit closer to this one. We may as well take a bit of a gamble. Expecting it to disappear. Look at its claws. Perfect for digging out prey. They like to feed on eggs that they can excavate out of the ground, eggs that may be buried. And also obviously very good for climbing up into trees like this. Look at its beady little eye. I'm hoping it decides to stick out its forked tongue to smell the air, to test our scent. Because that'll be great to see. Come on, put out that forked tongue of yours. It's got quite a fascinating little eyeball there. And aren't we lucky that it is a cool day? There's even a few small drops of rain falling on us, nothing too serious, but a few tiny little drops of drizzle. I'm not sure what it's like across N'Djuma, but this weather could be on the way there. It usually goes from west to east. Oh, I missed the tongue. I was looking away. But you guys got to see it, so well done. Unless, of course, some of you were blinking like I was at the time. Very good. Mike Costin, you would like me to give you the thoughts on what this lizard may be thinking about. Sheesh, doesn't look like too much, to be honest. Looked like it was sporting a serious hangover, if you're asking me. Hardly had any expression on its face, so I've got absolutely no guesses as to what it was thinking. It was maybe actually thinking, let me just keep still. And maybe they actually aren't watching me. Maybe they're just taking a look at this marula tree. So maybe that's what I was thinking. Very good. It's been a while since I've found you guys one of those monitors poking their holes out of the crevasse of a marula tree. It's one of the most common places we spot them out here. Wondering what animals will we see in this area seasonally, and in winter they'll be here and summer they won't, and vice versa. And it's only the birds really that are migratory. The rest of the animals we see here throughout the year, although some of the reptiles, the snails also, we only see them in the summer months. So even though they're here, they're just in estivation. They are hiding out during the winter, waiting for the summer bounty, which has not arrived this year. But yeah, it's mainly birds that migrate here, or animals that estivate here, come out in the summer months and lie dormant in the winter, which is dry. We don't have any major migrations of mammals coming and going from this area. There's slight seasonal changes, but each season may differ to the next. Well, the Erics are piling up on Safari Live. Now we've got one in New York who would like to know if it's normal for a giraffe to move alone. For the males, fairly common for them to move alone, yes. For the females, less common. You're more likely to see females in small herds. Although in some parts of Africa, you can get herds of 20, 30, 40 giraffe.
moving together. So a lot depends on where in Africa you are. The same species will often act differently in different parts of Africa. But the bulls, yes, not uncommon for them to be alone. The female that we saw earlier, even though she appeared to be alone, maybe there were a few more giraffes just ahead of her that we couldn't see in the thick bush. Approaching the Arethusa airstrip, maybe we're going to find a cheetah here, who knows? Who knows? They do like these open expanses though. Heidi in Arizona, I'm not sure if you were tuned in earlier, you obviously weren't, because then you would have seen my description and chat, about the Grevy zebra. I did show it in the book, so I don't know how possibly you couldn't have seen it unless you were not watching. But we do not get them here, we only get them in East Africa. The only zebra we get here is the virtual zebra. Now, feast your eyes on this. This is what you call a bush breakfast that is busy being set up for the lucky Arethusa guests. Can you believe it? White tablecloths, you can see all the juices on the table there, the waiters getting all the stuff ready, the chef's on the right of the operation there. I think he's just disappeared behind the car, he's running around frantically. That's Dave, the head chef at Arethusa. He's a very talented chef. I think he may be starting up a fire. Dave! He's so busy, he doesn't even know we're here. He started the fire. Dave! Oh no, he's not gonna hear us now because he started the car. There's the roaring fire. And awesome stuff. Maybe he's forgot the bacon and eggs back at the camp and that's why he's rushing off. Yeah, he's definitely forgot something important. Anyway, it's not uncommon to have these wonderful bush breakfasts when you come out to on safari. It's quite a lavish experience. There's nothing rough about being out on safari, especially in the Sabi Sands. It obviously depends on where you go and how rough you like it, but the Sabi Sands... Oh, I need to get out of Dave's way. Sorry, Dave! What did you forget? You forgot the glasses. And off he goes. Ah, that's awesome. So not uncommon, like I said, to be spoilt having a bush breakfast out in the bush. Sometimes what will even happen is you'll be driving around after dark with a spotlight, and next thing you come around the corner and you arrive at the most beautiful outdoor restaurants imaginable. Lanterns everywhere, up in the trees, chefs in their white suits having a dinner under the stars. So very, very special moments are made out here by the camps and the staff that work out here. They really go out of their way. Again, I'm talking in general, so don't quote me if you go to a lodge and this doesn't happen. But in general, they really do go out of their way to make sure that everyone that comes from far and wide does get absolutely spoiled rotten. Standard protocol to forget something. Okay, interesting. I've just got a radio call saying that you guys need to go over to Jamie because she has some good news. What does that mean? Go and see.
Guys, we just had the most awesome sighting. We bumped into, I suspect, one of the Nkuhuma females. She was just behind the squarry bush. We were following alarm calls. an entire herd of impala came racing across the road, and I suspect she might have been hunting them. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to try and call, I'm not entirely sure where Scott might be. I think he's still on Arethusa, but I'm going to call in one of the other vehicles to come and follow up. And we're really, really close to Galagopan. I'm just going to call this in. Station's out, visual of one fuzzy Ngala from Galago Shortcut. Very, very close to the link road with Galagopan. There's the alarm calls. She's moved off towards in that direction. Keep your eyes peeled. There, can you hear that? Impala shouting. That's harsh. Ba, ba, ba. Now, impala don't do that for nothing. It's usually leopard, cheetah, lion. Now, I know that it doesn't come through too clearly on my mic, but you do get it through. Now, the one thing that I can't do is follow her through this bush. Can you see the impala?
Yeah.
There's a chance she could come out this way. Just keep your eyes peeled. There's a nice open spot I want to just go look for. As I said, I'm not going to follow her, but I do want to move into an open gap where we have a chance of seeing her. Now she did see us. There's the impala there. They're looking straight in here. There's a nice open space. Stop. Oh, that's an impala. I thought I saw her moving through. She's somewhere in this thicket here. The impala all staring off in her direction. Let's just see if we can get a visual from the open clearing. Morning, impala. Was that a bit of a rude awakening? So they were staring off just into this gap in that direction. And the impala are going to move off away from where she was. She was just moving through in here, and I think she's still moving in that direction. It's awesome stuff. What a really cool end to our sunrise safari. So the Nkuma ladies were, well, I suspect it was the Nkuma ladies, and they were still on the property. So it was males that we heard calling this morning. Now, to try and do an approach now, we could do it. We're going to get me met with two responses. We've already seen her once. She got a bit of a fright and she moved off straight away. So if we follow her through here, she's going to do one of two things. She's either going to get really cross with us and give us a bit of a growl, or she's going to keep running. And obviously we don't want to do that. We don't want to push her to that extent. We had a really nice, brief, very close visual before she moved off. Now, I'm not going to follow her through this bush. Unfortunately, as appealing as the idea is, all I'm going to do is scare her. But oh, those tracks were so fresh this morning. I have tried to call in one of the vehicles, but what I'll try and do is after the end of our sunrise safari, we'll try and get to the vehicle and come and explore. They were right at Galagopan. That's where the lions were. We must have just missed them this morning. With those fresh tracks going down to the water, I assumed that they'd turned around and walked back to where Scott was, but obviously not. One of those things. We need to go and get the vehicle, I think. Well, Astralina's also made a good point. She was saying, surely it's not a good idea to follow a lion on foot if it's hunting. Her hunt was over. Oh, sorry, here's Craig. Let me try and get hold of him. Craig, standing by.
Morning, Jamie.
I'm
just
heading
to Sean. Apparently there's in Kwanza for Tingana and Tandi crossing north into Vuyas. Lucas open.
So Craig's just giving me an update about Tingana and Tandi coming onto the property. So we really do have some exciting prospects. Copy that. Thanks, Craig. I'm not sure your position, but I've just had visual of one Mufazi Ngala on Galago Shortcut, close to the shortcut junction to Galagopan. She's gone mobile now into the block, and I'm on foot, so I can't follow up.
Okay, copy.
So Astralina, you were saying surely it's not a good idea to follow a hunting lion. As I said, the hunt was over. Those immediate impala alarm calls.
North
And the fact that they were racing across the road, it means the hunt for her was not going to happen. As soon as an impala spots something like a lion, as we've spoken before, they're very much ambush predators. But the reason I'm not following her further in on foot is because all I'm going to do is scare her further. So following, I'm not necessarily following her, just trying to get an idea of exactly where she went. Bearing in mind also that our vehicle is straight back that way. So getting an idea of which way she's moved gives us a nice way of just looping around her and avoiding her. Of course, that being said, we don't actually know where the rest of the pride is. But yes, as soon as those, and you'll notice it with prey species, and I'm still standing listening for alarm calls while I'm here, but you'll notice very often with prey species that they'll be quite content to be quite close to the lions. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that brings us to an exciting end of our sunrise safari. I'm going to go and get the vehicle and try and find these lions on the vehicle. And once I do that, then it holds promising prospects for this afternoon's sunset safari. Plus, of course, tracks of Tundi and Tingana coming onto Vuyatela. As always, a big thank you to VM for being a hero with his backpack and not falling down into the drainage line and generally putting up with all kinds of odd requests to film things, including ticks. And as always, a big thank you to our viewers. As always, wonderful questions, wonderful comments. I hope you enjoyed this morning's bushwalk. We'll catch you this afternoon for the sunset safari. Cheers for now.
Yay, this might be another bird for your bird lists. This is the Retz's helmet shrike. We don't see them very often. We more often see their cousins, the white-crowned, white-crested helmet shrike. There we go. We got that in the bag, though. Oh, it looks like Dave may have spotted it again somewhere in there. It's so thick and windy, it's hard to tell what's going on in this marula tree. But you would have seen the bright red beak and the bright red eye around its eye. So I'm glad we could get you possibly another bird for your bird lists. What a morning it's been, and well done to Jamie and the walking team for bumping into a lion. Awesome stuff, and hopefully they'll be able to work out exactly where it is and whether the whole Inkahuma pride is there. I'm guessing that they could have split up. Anyway, it's been great fun. Thank you for joining us. Oh, what have I heard you? I think it's just leaves rattling. So I was just making sure that it wasn't the snakes or something slithering through the undergrowth. But I think it was just the leaves blowing in the wind. Thank you so much, everyone involved. Nikki, who directed the show, Kirsty, Jerry, and Leanne, who I think were all in the final control, possibly even Louise. Well done on your great camera work again, Dave. And thank you, of course, to all of you guys for joining us on the safari and sending through all of your questions, contributions, and action. I'm looking forward to the sunset safari already. We'll see you out there a little bit later.